We are in the home of Father Malachi Martin, and he has recently written a book called Windswept House. And we're going to be, in this first interview, discussing this book, because in addition to answering many questions that many Catholics have about the condition of the Church today, it also raises other questions, and it's those questions that we need to discuss today.
Yes, Bernard, I think that we should have a discussion about it, because the book is presented, by the way, in the form of a novel, and therefore the intent of the author can be seen through the novelistic framework. But since the book was published in last June, by the way, June 14, 1966, I've been on radio and talking to a lot of people on television and radio, and all the questions thrown at me concern not the truth or the falsehood. Most people realize that when this book tells a story of, say, about the Vatican or about a bishop in America or something in France, and that it's factual, but that the personalities have been hidden. There's been a certain novelistic form. It's very useful, by the way, a very useful literary genre. It's practiced by many people today. Geoffrey Archer, by the way, the British writer, uses it. And several other writers use it. Taylor Caldwell wrote all her books in this way. She wrote about the oil barons of her day and never mentioned any of their names. She had false names, but she wrote the story. So this is what this book does. So a discussion is necessary. People say, how much of it is factual, how much of it is imagination? And I've always told them that 85% of the personalities are actual, and 95% of the events are actual, but they're all cloaked in a novelistic form. It makes it easier to digest.
I'll tell you what my main reaction to the book was, and that was that it was realistic, because I know many families who have had their unity broken apart by the crisis in the Church, let's say like the Gladstone family did. And I know priests who have suffered, let's say, in the way that
Mike Riley.
Yes, who was frozen out of the diocese.
Sure, sure. Yeah, you've seen it. And I know that certain Catholics are in denial about this book and about the Church. They think everything is really hunky-dory. Yes, that we have difficulties. Who hasn't got difficulties? But there's great evangelization, there's great apostolicity, there's a great building up of devotion for the year 2000. We've got a very activist pope, and he's known and respected all over the world. We're 1 billion members. We're the biggest denomination in the world, religious denomination. And they're in total denial of the evils that beset this organization called the Roman Catholic Church.
And what would you say is the primary theme of Windswept House?
The primary theme, and this may surprise a lot of people, is this, that the organization, the Roman Catholic organization, as an organization that is composed of cardinals, British bishops, priests, religious, nuns, with schools and academies and institutions, parishes and dioceses, and everything that goes along with it, that this, as an organization, is in apostasy. And that's a very very, very strong statement, because, you know, it's one thing to be schismatic. If you're a schismatic, it means that you fight about some bishop's power or jurisdiction. It's one thing to be a heretic. Heretic is where you say, no, I don't believe there's a place called purgatory. I believe that God is too good. I don't believe that anybody goes to hell, which is against faith, by the way, incidentally, but I don't believe it. But I'm a heretic. If I say, well, no, I don't believe Our Lady was conceived immaculate, that's heresy. Doesn't mean you've lost your faith, it means you're very dangerously positioned to lose your faith. But when you're apostate, you've denied basic truths. God doesn't exist, there's no such thing as the Church, there's no hell, there's no such thing as divine grace, there's no such thing as sin, real sin, there's just social offenses. When you deny, go into sheer denial of basic truths, you're in apostasy. At the present moment, a sizable majority of people are in apostasy, have been led into apostasy, and a sizable minority of cardinals, bishops, priests, and religious are in apostasy. They no longer profess the basic truths of Christianity. Forget Catholicism.
And is this what distinguishes this crisis from previous crises in the Church? Because let's say during the Protestant Reformation, Luther and King Henry VIII did not walk away entirely from the basic beliefs of the Christian religion.
No, they were that part of jurisdiction. They fell into heresy, but they never doubted the existence of hell, or heaven, or sanctity, or divine grace, sanctifying grace, or authority in the church, or revelation of the magisterium. Just they claimed to be the magisterium. That was the only difference. But they never fell into this. This is worse than the Arian heresy of the early centuries, which denied Christ's divinity. This is a terrible situation where they simply do not believe that Jesus is in the Blessed Sacrament. They don't believe that Jesus knew he was God or was God. He became God. And they even go further than that. As you know, there's a man called Teilhard de Chardin, French Jesuit. He's dead now. He held that God didn't become man. Man is going to become God, which is a very different slant of things. And several of the cardinals at the present moment hold that. They no longer believe in the incarnation as we know it, or the resurrection as we know it. They are apostates, and they're in charge, Bernard. They're in charge of the church.
So this filters all the way down to laity who are practicing their faith in the parish.
It filters to the priests teaching the seminaries, because they find they can deny the divinity of Jesus, and nobody does anything to them. And for instance, when the present Bishop of Melbourne became bishop, he called in the faculty, Bishop Pell is his name, and said, "I now insist that you teach traditional Catholic doctrine." You know what happened? The faculty resigned. They said, "I'm sorry, Bishop, we like you, we respect you, but we don't believe these things any longer." The whole faculty resigned in Melbourne.
So this situation then also explains why unity in the church has broken down.
Yes, why there is no unity.
So there's no meeting of the minds, let's say, between the believers and the apostates.
None whatever. And it also is responsible for the arise of what we now know as the underground church. That is, an extensive network of bishops, priests, religious, nuns, schools, Blessed Sacrament chapels, confessions, and rider priests throughout America and Canada and Latin America and in Europe. There is an underground church which is flourishing. It's minor, it's small, but it's flourishing, and more people are being attracted to it because they're leaving the conciliarist church, what I call the conciliarist church. That is, they follow absolutely rigidly what is said about Vatican II, the Second Vatican Council, and they're in apostasy. They don't know it. You know, Bernard, the big pity is this. There's no doubt about it. We have 66 million Catholics, I think, in these United States, if they were to tell the truth about the numbers. And the majority are being led by the nose out of the true faith, and they don't know it, because they're obedient. And the priest says it's okay to be homosexual, it's all right to divorce and be remarried and come to the sacraments. If the priest says that, well, it's all right, you won't go to hell, God doesn't send anybody to hell, it doesn't really exist. And the devil, that's a myth. And the priest says that, and the bishop says that. People say, well, hey, come on, what do we believe?
So the apostates, they would not see any reality outside of what you could see and hear and touch and feel. They would deny the existence, or they wouldn't include in their worldview the eternal and the supernatural.
Oh, no, that's gone. The devils, the angels, the saints. There is something after death called heaven. It's a pleasant place. Everybody goes to it. It was the general idea, and God never sends anybody into a dark and murky hole called hell. No. Or purgatory, that's all mythic, mythological. That's the outlook. That's apostasy. And that's the... You see, Bernard, look, if you tell me you're a believer, and then I find that in practice you act as if none of it was true, and I question you and find out that you really don't believe in hell, you don't believe in angels, you don't believe in purgatory, that's what you really believe, no matter what you say by rote profession or saying I'm a Roman Catholic. You're not. You're an apostate.
Well, that's one of the characteristics of the current hierarchy, is that they don't usually openly deny these doctrines and dogmas of the faith. They just more or less live their faith and live their lives as if these doctrines don't exist.
Yeah, that's right. In abstraction from them. They abstract from them completely. They don't exist any longer. And that's the difficulty. That's what's happening.
And would this apostasy then explain why, let's say, these clergymen, let's say, would show no interest in the rosary.
That's right. But why finger beads like a Muslim? I mean, these are prayer beads. These are worry beads like the Greeks have, and they fiddle with them. There's nothing. What are you doing? Going from Hail Mary to... You're saying 50 Hail Marys at one rush? Listen here. It's not even humanly sensible to do that. So they don't see any use in that, and then they don't believe in Our Lady's privileges. That's all gone. That's faith. And the terrible thing is, Bernard, that if you lose your faith, you don't know you have lost it. Because if you knew you'd lost it, you'd have got it back.
You see, these men just carry on churchmen. Like, they don't walk out of the church. They still view themselves as good Catholics.
I do. Now, I must tell you a story in connection with that, which is rather frightening. I remember I worked with a cardinal during the Vatican Council called Cardinal Baer. And he came in to me one day, and he was perspiring. He never perspired. He was only 83. But it wasn't so much his age, it was that he never perspired. And he was perspiring and he was trembling. And I said, Eminence, what has happened? He said, I've just been listening to a conversation between Hans Küng and Skillebeck. There were two theologians, way out theologians, who were both apostates. And he said, I heard Skillebeck say, well, then we can't stay in this church. And Küng said, no. In the 16th century with the Protestants, we left the church and we lost. This time we're staying inside and we're going to change it.
All of this crisis in the church, though, it must have had some type of a source. It wouldn't just come from nowhere. What would this source be?
Well, as you know, today, universally in the media and in literature and in commentators above all, anybody who speaks about a conspiracy is labeled as a conspiratorial freak. But we do now know, we have the evidence of it, and someday we can publish it all. We do now know that there was a plan which influenced John the 23rd to call the council. And once the council was called, we now know that cardinals like Cardinal Sunens of Belgium and Koenig of Vienna and a whole list of German cardinals and French cardinals connived to change the council from being a Catholic council to being what it became, as something which disrupted the tradition of the church and which produced the documents that are now formed the basis of the universal apostasy in the Roman Catholic Church. We now know that. It was a carefully laid plan, and it came from non-Catholic sources. Why? Well, look at it like this. It's now the 1950s, and the strongest growing body in the international sphere is the Roman Catholic Church. And it has a very strong pope called Pacelli, who is going to die immediately. And they're spreading all over the world and a great respectability. What do you do about that? You plan to disrupt it from inside, to penetrate it. And therefore you penetrate it by means of co-opting several cardinals into the Masonic Lodge, become members of the Lodge, and very respectable members of the Lodge, and bishops also, and priests, and you proceed to introduce homosexuality as quite an acceptable mode of life for anybody, including priests and nuns. You do this very carefully. That is what has happened. Who formed that plan? Well, whether people like it or not, and later history will show conclusively, we have very dire enemies who see the Roman Catholic Church as the one big obstacle to their plans. Why? Because the Roman Catholic Church says, I have ultimate authority over anything you do. Anything you do, which is a moral action, I am the authority. Number two, I am also the authority on education. I must have the children to educate. They have to be educated by me in the beginning. We claim education. And thirdly, then, we claim, finally, to be the source of all power. Very few people know it, Bernard. But finally, papal doctrine is that even political power descends through the papacy. The papacy doesn't insist on that any longer because it's not accepted. But de facto, all power on earth comes from Christ. And his only vicar on earth is the Pope. And the idea of democracy, that it's the people of power, I'm sorry, that's not Catholic. The people have power through Christ, from Christ. The idea that power resides in the people and people can give the power to whom they like, that's a half-boiled doctrine. The full doctrine is that all power comes from Christ. He said it himself, all power is given to me in heaven and on earth. He told the apostles. And therefore, it descends through him or through his vicar, who is only one man and one man only. And we have now the 264th successor of Peter in the throne, and he is, through Christ, the source of political power, political authority, political authenticity, political genuineness. That's the true Catholic doctrine.
But these enemies go back, I think, right from the time that Christ walked this earth. Because wasn't there a meeting of the Sanhedrin to do something to stop Jesus?
Sure. But they were only acting, you see, about it whether people admit it or not. And it's irrelevant whether they admit it or not. In this world, you're either serving Christ or you're serving Lucifer. There are only two issues at stake. There's good and there's bad. And good is represented by Christ and bad is represented by Lucifer. You may not know Christ. You may be a Buddhist who never heard of him. Or if you did, you heard about it vaguely. You may be a Muslim who never heard about it. You can be a Muslim in Indonesia or in Algeria or in Saudi Arabia and never know about Christ. But if you're serving good, you're serving Christ. And the grace to do so comes through Christ one way or the other. If you don't, if you're cruel, if you're evil, if you're pernicious, if you're a liar, if you're a perjurer, that's all the work of Lucifer, who no matter what your form of religion is, no matter who, what your color of your skin is, it's from Lucifer. Those two divide up humanity. And today, unfortunately, the denial of Christ's revelation is abroad in the Church of Christ. The organization. That's the difficulty. And people have got to, I find more and more Catholics and more people have got to, even non-Catholics, I always point out to them, there's a distinction between the union of all believers who are practicing their faith and those and the organization which vehicles that. The Roman Catholic Church is the ideal vehicle for believers in Christ. But it's only an organization and it's fading. And one of the themes of Windswept House, the sub-theme of this book, is that in a short time, humanly speaking, there will be no Holy Roman Catholic Church organization visible. There won't be any. And we must deal with that.
But something must have happened, like, that would have caused, let's say, since the 1960s, for this organization to seemingly start self-destructing.
Auto-demolition. Yeah, there was this consecration, this enthronement of Satan within the Vatican, of Lucifer, by the way.
Now, did that actually happen?
Yes, it's a historical fact. It was done one particular day by a certain group of people representing Luciferians all over the world, especially American Luciferians. It was done. And therefore, in a certain sense, Lucifer has power. He doesn't own yet. But I'm sure he hopes to own some pope as his man. I'm sure he does. And he expects to own some pope, not the present pope, but some pope, so that the house is really his. And the only one who can expel him is the owner of the house. And that owner is the pope. And he must carry out the exorcism.
Now,
and the cleansing of the house.
Some people who have read Windswept House, after they read about this enthronement of Satan, said, ah, now I understand why there is this crisis in the church. Because doesn't it have a spiritual cause?
It must have. It must have. And that's why I remember going to Rome there last year and speaking with a very, very well-known cardinal and saying to him, but Your Eminence, you have got to go to the Holy Father and explain this. He said, no, what can I do? I'm only a simple cardinal. And I said, well, if you don't do it, who's going to do it? He said, nobody. Nobody's going to do it. Nobody will tell the Holy Father the truth. And he's too busy and too worn down to do anything about this. And that's the situation. And until that is done, by the way, there are 8 exorcists working in the Vatican under Father Amort, Gabriel Amort, who's a very good exorcist. But he is not the owner of the house. He doesn't represent Christ.
So only the Pope can really resolve this crisis in the church.
Can exorcise the demons. Yeah.
And this would certainly explain then why, let's say, many good women, men and women who have, let's say, who are priests, who are parents of children, have maybe worked here and there to do something, and maybe they can save some souls. But that explains then why all the efforts, let's say, of pro-lifers and traditionalists...
Come to naught. Let me give you one example of one dire effect. That people just blink at this now, but they should suddenly say, how could that happen? In the same day, within 36 hours, this Holy Father had to receive Mikhail Gorbachev and Fidel Castro. Now, Mikhail Gorbachev is the founder of the New World Religion, which people don't know about yet. He's the founder of it, and he's an atheist, and he's a Marxist. And he has no religion. Fidel Castro is an evil man who has stopped practicing religion for 30 or 40 years and who has been cruel beyond description. They're invited, they come in, they shake the Pope's hand, they sit down with him and talk to him. But you don't do that. You don't do that. You don't entertain the devil's people, and they belong to Lucifer. You don't do that. But the Pope did.
Now let's, I have a question or two about Gorbachev.
Yes.
Does Gorbachev still play an important role in world politics, even though he's no longer head of the Soviet Union?
He's in a much more powerful position. He's just drawn up the Earth Charter, the Charter for the Earth, which is the Charter for the New World Order, and it has its own new commandments instead of the Ten Commandments, and people haven't got around to reading it yet, but it's going to be voted on by the United Nations and become law for all nations to foment this Earth Charter, which means we revert to worshipping nature, and we regard man as an evil influence in this world, and as a pernicious destroyer of and polluter of Mother Nature, and Mother Nature is everything, which is worship of the earth. Gaia is the name of the goddess. But Michael Gorbachev is a cruel atheist. And how could you receive him with honor? How could you receive Fidel Castro, who has prisoners dying in his famous island prison, and who is a Marxist of the worst order and has persecuted the church? You don't receive these people.
Well, hasn't the Pope had a relationship with Gorbachev for some time?
Yes, and it's always scandalized us. Why? You don't have that sort of relationship with somebody like Mikhail Gorbachev. You must meet him. The Pope has 101 clerics and prelates who can talk to him in his own language. But they should receive him with honor in the Vatican, in Christ's house, in the house of the successor of Peter, who is the vicar of Christ. No, you don't do that. It's just too much. You just don't do that. Not for my mind, not for the Catholic mind. And you don't entertain that. It's just the same as if the Pope at the time of, say, 1520, received Luther with honor in the Vatican. Oh, come on.
Well, wouldn't that act to, let's say, in this situation, to demoralize, let's say, the faithful believers behind the Iron Curtain?
It does. It does demoralize us. It does demoralize. That's why when Nikita Khrushchev's son-in-law, Adjubei, came to the Vatican, he was received by John XXIII with his wife, everybody was shocked by it. How can you receive a man like that? He's actively persecuting the church. How can you do that? And similarly with members of the Chinese government who are persecuting the church. Now it's all done, they say, in the name of diplomacy, and the church has to exercise diplomatic power, but nothing ever comes of it except the nourishment of a certain disillusionment in everybody. So, well, if they get on, it mustn't be so bad. They must be okay, one way or the other must be all right. So I'm pointing this out as the effect of the Luciferian influence in the Vatican. No doubt about it, Lucifer is the prince, and he has now a place within the central citadel of the church.
Now, in your book, there is an exorcist called Father Slattery.
That's right.
And you are an exorcist as well. What perspective does being an exorcist give you about the current crisis in the church?
As an exorcist, when you do exorcisms, minor and major, the demons constantly taunt you with the condition of the church. They say, well, we're in St. Peter's. We can talk to whom we like. We have representatives sitting beside your Pope every day. What are you talking about? We are legit. I'm quoting demons now. This is what is said to you. How dare you? And our prince has been enthroned, installed. And you're still against us? What are you trying to persecute us for when you're trying to expel demons? And it's a dreadful thing. Oh, you keep repeating the name of Jesus and the prayers and the command to get out. They eventually do, under protest. But what they fling at you is that. Or they say, well, we're in honor amongst the cardinals of France. The prince is worshipped by some of these people. We can't be so bad as all that. Why are you against us?
Now, there's a point I'd like to raise here, is that the way that Satanists are portrayed, let's say in Hollywood,
yes,
or in the movies, is quite a bit different from the description of the Satanist that was in Windswept House.
Oh yes, it's very different. It's very different because, say if you take, for instance, The Exorcist, the picture of called The Exorcist, with Linda Blair in it, and, based on Blatty's book, which is based on a real event, by the way, but distorted totally by Blatty and the picture. It really is Dracula Frankenstein horror film to make you shiver, give you goosebumps. And people love getting goosebumps. They love being made nervous, but it's all in the imagination. It's like any horror movie, like any Dracula Frankenstein movie. That's one thing. But I assure you, the reality of exorcism, the reality of demon possession, is totally different. I remember, to give you an example, there was a Dr. Hammond psychologist who always kept saying the same thing. He said, this is all imagination. He said that these people require very careful therapy. So finally, and he said, let me be present at an exorcism, thing we don't do normally. So finally we admitted him. Hammond never went back to psychiatry. He became a Catholic, and he was Jewish originally. Once he was hit by the reality of a demon, of demonic presence. It's something that you don't forget, and it's nothing like looking at The Exorcist or any of the Satanist pictures with Satan with claws and cloven hooves and big yellow eyes and cruel. No, that's lovely imagination, and people love it because it's goosebumps.
But it's not reality.
Not reality, no.
And the reality seems to be, then, that these Satanists tend to be very respected men in respected professions.
The Satanists I know, who belong to Luciferian and Satanist covens in New York, are all lawyers, doctors, architects, nurses, brokers, businessmen, entrepreneurs, and they're perfectly respectable citizens. They pay their taxes. They even contribute to the local church. Some of them are Catholic, some of them are Protestant, some of them are Jewish. No, they're perfectly respectable as far as civic life goes. They're models of civic behavior, and they usually have great sexual probity and business probity. Their word is their bond, and their work as surgeons or as doctors or research scientists is impeccable. No, they're perfectly respectable, but they are worshippers of Lucifer.
And these men, do they have a very large undetected influence?
Of course they have, because they constantly represent the Satanist influence, the Luciferian principle, that there's nothing above the sky and there's nothing beneath the earth, there's just us alive for 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 years, and then it's over. So, snatch the day.
And these Luciferians, these Satanists, then have also penetrated and gained a largely undetected influence even within the church then.
Unfortunately, that is the situation. We have the fact that prelates and priests and nuns, but above all prelates in the church, have become members of covens and worship Satan and worship Lucifer, because they're distinct demons. And Lucifer is the prince and Satan is the aide-de-camp. He's the lie-by, he does the skullduggery work. Lucifer presides and is the prince, as Christ called him, the prince of this world. I can't tell you how shocking it is when you find out that a prelate is a member of a coven and he actually worships Satan, worships Lucifer, you have no idea how it seems to be such a desecration. It's like it's Judas's kiss on Jesus' cheek that night, kissing him.
So it's an act of betrayal.
Oh yes, it's a Judas priest act. And the dreadful thing is, a few of them, for some reason or other, which I can't make out theologically, they come for help. In a vague sense, they'll talk about their lives and talk about the church and then talk about decisions they make, and they will say, well, do you think that was unworthy of me as a bishop? And I said, yes, I think it was very unworthy of you. I think it helped the prince. And they'd blench at that. That was almost a blow across the face to them. And they'd say, well, I'll think about these things, but I can't break away at the present moment. They can't give it up. And if you said to them, as I did, you want me to pray for you, well, you're free, because they don't believe they can be saved. They've given up completely.
Is there a distinction then amongst the enemies of the church, let's say within the church, between those men who know what they're doing in serving Lucifer,
yes,
and those people who, let's say, during the Cold War were called useful idiots?
Yes, there is a distinction. There is a distinction. But when you finally unravel any one of the idiots, they finally begin to see that they themselves willingly were co-opted, willingly were taken, and refused to think, because the advantages they got were huge.
So there's always a measure of responsibility
always,
then?
Always, always, always. The only thing is, some are destined to fulfill important jobs. Some of them are destined to become cardinals, which is very important. Some of them are just simple priests, simple bishops, very much. But some of them are destined to be influential, and therefore can do so much harm. And they get special attention. Believe you me, they get special attention from this. And they get special treatment, and they get enlightenment. They have light. They devise a means of doing what they're supposed to do. And they get riches, and they get preference, and they're liked. And then there's this, Bernard, which is a very frightening phenomenon. They know each other. I can never explain this, but they know, even in a crowd, they'll find each other. There's a spiritual smell. There's a sign on their forehead. I don't know what it is. They know each other. Even if they've never met before, once they belong to him.
And they will protect each other and promote each other.
Absolutely. More degrees to death. Unto death. Unto your destruction, if necessary. Rather than injure the interests of the prince.
Now, what I would like to know is, what is the agenda of these Luciferians within the church? What is their agenda for the Catholic Church?
The agenda is this. They, because this is the Luciferian wish, they want to completely de-supernaturalize Roman Catholic teaching so that we become good, unsupernaturally motivated human beings, and therefore accede to their plans for humanity, which are very dire plans. For instance, let me tell you. We have a large amount of Catholics today who practice contraception in America. So talk about America alone. And 66% practice contraception. 66%, the latest figure. We have a large number of them who practice abortion, the intending moment abortion. We have, by the way, many Catholic families with two children. They have no more children. You know why? They've undergone sterilization. Either he's had a vasectomy or she's had her tubes tied up. As a deliberate act. So they're living in sin, and they have joined, therefore, a thing which is very, very important. But I want you to gaze out over a vast horizon in order to see this. The biggest tendency today in medicine, in the medical field, in the health field, is to prolong life as long as possible. And to push it beyond 60 to 70 to 80 to 90 the year, the term of life. Their aim is to make it perpetual. And now the medical theory is that if you can replace all the organs, including the brain, but all the other organs, so eyes, chest, genitalia, lungs, pancreas, all the organs, you live forever. To do that, you need replacements. To get replacements, you need to harvest the organs. And therefore the biomedical aim of research today is to develop what they call, not humanoids, subhumans. Anencephalics, with no brain, but with perfectly good hearts, perfectly good cornea, perfectly good ears, perfectly good pancreas, perfectly good everything. And to harvest them like you would. So to harvest them like donors.
So this would take, let's say, it would be the next stage past abortion.
That's right.
Because, let's say, in the womb doesn't have, let's say, all what you might be able to need for this prolongation of life.
No. It's next stage. But accustoming people to the idea of killing the babies, of liquidating human beings who are too old, euthanasia and abortion at one end and the other end, bring it down to the living. And for today, there's no doubt about it. If you have Parkinson's disease, you're treated with matter taken from fetuses. Living. They have to get the fetus alive to cut it out. Tuberculosis is the same thing. It's harvesting from a living baby. That's why they have living babies delivered. For that reason alone, they pay somebody to have a baby so they can harvest its organs. The cosmetic factories, the big cosmetic names that make your powder and your creams that are used in cosmetics, they're all using fetal matter.
So really,
harvested from the living baby. So this is, the point I'm making to you is this: anybody who supports abortion, anybody who has their tubes bound up, a woman, or has this vasectomy performed, anybody joining that stream of development is moving humanity closer and closer to this development of the subhuman. Because they're going to have that, whether we like it or not. And harvest it for organs, so that your eyes will never give out, and your heart will never give out, and your genitals will never give out, and your pancreas will never give out, and your kidneys will never give out. We can replace everything. Liver, kidneys, everything, can deliver everything. All your veins, we can replace the veins. We have beautiful veins in these people, because they're only subhumans. They're not human.
So part of the purpose then, part of the Luciferian agenda is to reshape the church so that it's no longer a barrier to this new morality.
It's just a willing nourisher of the new world order, of this order of privileged human beings who can develop their happiness, paradise on earth, longer and longer and longer. The church at the present moment is the big obstacle. It's against abortion, against contraception. It should preach that there's only one aim in life, that's to get to heaven. They said, forget it. This is the pernicious myth that we've got to get rid of. And we get rid of that by getting at the center, the central teacher, and that's the Pope. That's the papacy. That's the priest. That's the cardinal. That's the Roman congregation. That's the diocesan rule. Corrupt the bishops, corrupt the cardinals, corrupt the Pope. Have a Pope on our side.
So
that's the aim.
Part of the aim too, like I don't think you couldn't just capture the Pope in a day.
No.
So is partly the aim to surround him then with men who will paralyze
sure,
his actions.
Sure, sure. And eventually that one of them will be elected and chosen as Pope, who will be perfectly complacent, who will say, okay, we stop this nonsense about being anti-abortion, stop this business of anti-contraception. These things are part of living today. We must curb the human population. And that's apparently the way the plan is going to work. So that observant Catholics, traditionalist Catholics, will become hunted like dogs. Like dogs. And by the way, today already, it is already a liability to be a Christian or a Catholic. Remember that the Supreme Court of the United States, in three or four decisions, major decisions in the last 10 years, have said quite plainly, in the public square in America, if you bring into consideration a transcendent view, you have no right to speak. That's in America. So you can't adduce any Catholicism, any the Ten Commandments, the Bible. That has any transcendent view, which is not here and now, the positive law, forget it, pal, you have no place in the public square in America. So it is already a liability to be a Catholic.
So what we're really heading towards then is perhaps a parallel of what happened in the French Revolution, where you had an underground church that was persecuted, and wasn't there also kind of a state church that the revolutionaries formed?
That's right.
That was kind of a state agency.
That's right. And the Stalinists in Poland tried the same thing with the Pax priests, the priests of Pax organization.
Or in China, you have the Patriotic Church.
That's right, the same thing. They haven't been able to do much with that because the Chinese are far more practical. And then the difficulty is that the Pope collaborates with that because he has Cardinal O'Connor educating the Chinese Patriotic priests in Dunwoody Seminary here in New York. So there's a very fluid attitude to that.
And these patriotic priests, let's say in China, wouldn't object to, let's say, the Chinese government's
abortion laws.
No, yeah.
No, they don't. They don't. They can't. They wouldn't. They don't. They don't. And you see, then, Bernard, the Pope's man from Beijing, the Pope's man who goes to Beijing and talks with the Chinese is Echegaray. He's a Frenchman from Marseille. Echegaray is a homosexual. And I doubt if Echegaray is a believer any longer. I doubt it. But he's the one who negotiates all this. And he gives John Paul a story about what can be done, and he's the diplomat. So the Pope follows him. The Pope has this Polish tradition of not interfering with a man. Once you give him an office, let him perform it, no matter what he does, unless it becomes blatantly adversative and unacceptable. So the corruption goes on. That's Windswept House, and that's why I call the book Windswept House, because it refers to an actual house which is windswept, but it also refers symbolically to the Catholic Church.
So it has a double meaning then?
It has a double meaning. There's a wind blowing through this church today.
And that wind comes from Lucifer?
Yes, it is. That has brought him into the house, and he's now in power.
Now, what I'd like to do is take a look at some of the influence that, let's say, these Luciferians inside the church have had, maybe only indirectly. How have they been able to reshape church life, let's say, from the time of the Second Vatican Council till today?
Well, I'll tell you, look at what they have effected. They have made it so that they have successfully suppressed or transferred major feast days. There's only three or four feast days in the whole year when you must go to Mass. And even then, they can transfer it to a Sunday, so that you're not bound to go anywhere at all. There's no... that's number one, prayer, just prayer.
Let's stop right here. I'd like to have a short discussion about the new calendar,
yes,
because I can see that as a very disruptive influence on your pious Catholics,
of course,
to be shifting saints' days around, and I think even some were expunged from the calendar.
Completely. But you see, that, therefore, and when they were asked, when they suppressed St. Philomena, people wrote in to Rome and said, do you mean to say she never existed? I said, no. We don't want the feast day.
But do these people, do they realize the pain and anguish that it causes, let's say, a good Catholic who's been praying to St. Philomena all these years?
They don't care. They don't care.
So what we
they
see,
don't care.
What we see here is a theme of the book coming out, and that's kind of the wickedness of it all.
That's right. That's right.
We're seeing a fulfillment then of the prophecy that charity would run cold in the end times.
That's right.
That they don't even care, let's say, about the laity who have these devotions. They wouldn't care about the career of they wouldn't care about ruining the career of a priest.
Oh no, not at all. And then you see, you should be in receipt, and really, but you couldn't spend the time doing it, to receive the accounts that we received of, say, the Diocese of Louisville, Kentucky, what the bishop has done to the people, closing the churches, forbidding the devotions. They now have to bring in their own priests, and they have their underground masses. And the same thing in other dioceses around the country. The bishop simply is cutting them off and will not nourish their devotion, or will not give them masses when they need them, won't hear confessions, and the priests are dead afraid to move because they'll be punished, they'll be dismissed.
Now, in, I think it is the Archdiocese of Edmonton in Canada, they've removed all the kneelers from the churches.
Well, that's another move to make, so you don't kneel down, because now they don't want you to kneel down.
So that, in a sense, represents the loss of this eternal and supernatural vision.
Sure, sure it does. And, but they haven't got that any longer. They say kneeling down is unworthy of you. You're a human being. You have dignity. And the whole thing is to live with dignity and to die with dignity. By the way, Bernard, in parentheses, let me tell you, did you ever see anybody dying with dignity? It's the most undignified act. Dying is terrible. You give up your spirit, you're incontinent, you're breathing badly, and you're dying like any dog does. Dignity? No. There's dignity only when you've confessed your sins, and people are praying with you, and you die with a prayer in your lips. That's the only dignity you could have. But to tell me that I'm going to die with dignity is a joke. No, death is the most awful humiliation going.
You could not have a dignified death within the framework of the natural world.
It just can't. It just can't. Because you're beaten. You're emptied out of life. You're a hollow shell. Disease has eaten into you. And you're breathing your last and you can't do anything about it. And you're sweating. And you're defecating. And urinating. And you're helpless. And nobody can help you, and you die with a very deep sigh, you give up your whole spirit. Dignity, Bernard, the word doesn't mean anything.
So what we're really seeing then is that life really only makes sense within the framework of the Catholic faith.
That's right.
And
that's right.
Any attempt to build this earthly utopia is bound to fail, because they ultimately, all these Luciferians and people who have followed them must meet death and their maker at some point.
That's right. No matter how facile a way that Dr. Kerkorian or the death doctors develop for you with acids and with drinks, etc., you finally come to the point that you die with utter indignity. And on top of all that, you're faced with Lucifer, who says, well, you belong to me now, because you committed suicide. And Christ looks away from you. He turns his face away, and you are damned forever. So dying with dignity is so stupid. Living with dignity is something else. And the idea that the church was founded in order to facilitate the creation of a paradise on earth is totally unchristian. And yet, I mean, John Paul II will go to France and declare on landing there that the church believes that its purpose is to establish universal brotherhood. That's nowhere in tradition.
And didn't Paul VI talk about building an earthly paradise?
He did. This is his big address at the end of the Vatican Council. We now join the world. I'm sorry, pal. The church has not joined the world. It's crucified to the world.
So even then, some Catholics who are not, let's say, Luciferians, have bought in to this philosophy.
They have, because their Pope says it, their bishops say it, their priests say it. Hey. They're the only sources they have, unless they start thinking. But you see, it's much easier to fit into this world of paradise. It means you can accumulate wealth, it means that you can enjoy yourself, it means that you haven't got to be very strict about Sundays and about abortion, about contraception, about masturbation, about occasional flirtations, about shady business deals, as far as you get away with it. So it makes life much easier.
And wouldn't it also make life easier then for the churchmen, who can then hobnob with the local
sure.
Legislators
sure,
and
sure.
judges?
And do, and become Freemasons and get the benefit of belonging to the local lodge.
And not have to be hunted down, let's say, like some of the church leaders were, let's say, in the French Revolution
in
the communist countries.
Sure, it's much easier. And by the way, then, let's put it like this. It's far easier to say the Novus Ordo as a ceremony than to say the traditional Mass. The traditional Mass is a disciplined movement. Every action is dictated. You must follow the rubrics. It's quite a strain to do it.
And don't you have to essentially keep your own personality out of it, because you're acting in persona Christ?
Of course. But in the Novus Ordo, there's great... I mean, it's good morning, everybody. How are we all this morning? It's a totally different thing. It's
so, in Windswept House, Channing, who definitely was an open and willing Luciferian,
sure.
said that they've had an immense influence on the new liturgy.
Sure, and he had, and they had. And Dr. Channing is a real person. but I will not reveal his identity. He is a very important Luciferian in the world.
So the Luciferians then have had an influence on shaping the new mass.
Enormous, enormous, enormous. You see, they, Paul VI formed a committee of 8 people. 2 of them Catholics, 6 of them non-Catholics, to draw up the new mass, the Novus Ordo. And they finally, he chose Luther's mass. And he had to modify that when people started grumbling. But basically it was Luther's mass, who didn't believe in the real presence. Didn't believe in the consecration. He didn't believe in the real presence. And he also disbelieved other things too. And he was very violently anti-Catholic and anti... That's why it's very hard to understand why the present Holy Father praised Martin Luther as a man of profound religious conviction and a great theologian. As far as we're concerned, he was a dirty-minded heretic who died blaspheming. But
he did this, I think... during his trip to Scandinavia in 1989, didn't
he? That's right. And he's done it since, too.
So is it one of the thrusts of the new church is to have it fit in with the world, to go along, to get
that's
along?
Right. That's right. That's the movement. That's the movement. And even in Pope John Paul II's last encyclical, that there may be one famous encyclical.
That's Ut Unum Sint?
Ut Unum Sint. In that he said, look, as regards the papal primacy, well... perhaps we could talk about that too. Now, Bernard, if you say to me, Malachy, I want to discuss abortion, the pros and the cons, I'll say, I'm sorry. There is no pro. Here's what we say about abortion, period. If you say to me, Malachy, I want to discuss the possibility of homosexual activity as an alternative, I say, I'm sorry. There's some things I would not discuss as possible. Similarly, there's no discussion of papal primacy. He has this primacy and this leadership and jurisdiction and infallibility, and I'm not discussing it. I'll explain it to you. If you want to explain it, I'll explain it. Every item of it, and the history of it, and the meaning of the doctrine. But I will not discuss it as a possible alternative.
So this dialogue that all modernists seem to be very fond of, dialogue has no place in certain areas.
None. And that was the great error and the great crafty behavior of Cardinal Bernardine. He started what he called the Common Mind Project, which, by the way, is mirrored in Winthrop House. We learned about it a year before he launched it.
Now, that's one thing that struck me was kind of a very scary feeling when I pick up, let's say, my copy of The Wanderer and read about the Common Ground Project that was very close to the Common Mind vote.
Same thing, same thing. Bernardine is a very crafty man, and he proposed a dialogue. Let's talk, let's not fight. Okay, you like abortion, I dislike abortion. You think homosexuality is good, and I think it's not so good. And then we, this, that, and the other. Let's dialogue about it. And if you read his speech at that Monday morning press conference where he announced this, the whole thing, it's quite obvious that he wrote it, the speech he would have given at the conclave for the next pope, but he knew he was dying. And his vision of the church, where we learn to dialogue about everything, and the only thing that matters is that we dialogue. What you believe, old man, doesn't matter. What I believe doesn't it doesn't matter, it's immaterial. The important thing is we keep talking, and you can say what you like, you have a right to say it, and do as you like, and I have a right to say what I like and do as I like. But we must dialogue. We must dialogue.
Isn't that the key principle of what is known as the Renew Program then as well?
That's right. Well, the Renew Program is definitely Luciferian. There's no doubt about that.
So there's another aspect of this Luciferian agenda in that it seems it's the kind of thing very good.
It does. Sounds very democratic and very equitable and fair-minded and as some of them would say, Christ-like. Therefore, it's gentle and forgiving and permissive and human and understanding, and it makes life easy. People don't hate each other. They can eat and drink together and go to bed together, I suppose, too. But if I can make an ugly joke, which they make themselves. But the point is, there's certain things where there is no compromise, there's no discussion.
So this has always kind of been a trick of Satan,
always.
Is to snare people by proposing something that looks on the surface, let's say, to be glamorous.
That's right.
To be appealing, but is humanly appealing, but really serves an evil purpose.
Of course, because it wipes out, You see, if all religions are true, there is no true religion, because they contradict each other. And if it is okay for anybody to say or do anything, provided he respects your human rights, defined by positive law, not by God, if that's the way it is, then what's the point of any spiritual activity? There's none whatever. And therefore, there's no such thing as the true faith, there's no such thing as the one true church, there's no such thing as there's no salvation outside the church. All that is out the window. And that's what is proposed today. And if you go to, I've been at meetings where I've talked about the doctrine of the Church of Catholics, meeting 400 of them, I'm thinking of an audience I had recently in New York, and the moment I said that only Catholics will get to heaven and outside the Church there's no salvation, there was almost an audible hiss. They almost flung plates at me. It was a breakfast. The chaplain who was standing beside me nearly hit me, because it's dead against the new ethos where everybody's okay. You go traveling by road 22, I'm traveling by 21, we're both arriving at the same good, holy, kind, benign, gentle Godfather. So why should we differ? And we can marry, no difficulty. Why should we not marry together? And why shouldn't we go to church together, have the same prayers? Because it's all the same. And we can discuss anything. We can discuss abortion, you can discuss contraception, you can discuss papal infallibility, you can discuss the possibility there's no hell, or if there is a hell, there's nobody in it. And you don't get all head up at me, you don't condemn me.
And that sounds very good, but how does a soul, an individual, resist these arguments which can be very seductive?
Only with sanctifying grace. And he only gets sanctifying grace through the sacraments.
And that is why perhaps then the Luciferians acted in order to prevent the sacraments from really functioning as they should.
That's right, for being valid. And you can go through every one of the seven sacraments, including baptism, and show that as they now are practiced, they can be totally invalid.
In the first interview, we discussed Windswept House, the major theme of which was the apostasy, the ultimate source of which was Lucifer. And now I would like to discuss some of the characteristics of the New World Order that they're trying to put in place. What are the main characteristics of the New World Order that's coming into place towards the end of the 20th century?
Well, I'll tell you, Bernard, it's a very important question, because a lot of people, when they hear about the New World Order, say, oh, that means a new world government. There'll be one government that will govern everybody. And that's not the idea of the New World Order, number one. Number two, the New World Order, in its essence, is already here. It's established. We can't get out of it, whether you like it or not. Or whether you know it, it is here. What is this? It's this, that today there is no country which cannot be divided into three parts. There's always the government, and it's more and more important than it ever was before. There's the business community, and then there's a group of things called NGOs, non-governmental organizations. Everything from mad mothers against drunk drivers over to the Catholic Church. That's where the church is today. That's where religion is. It's simply one of a mass of civil organizations that are competing in the public square.
So it's being demoted.
That's right. I mean, when something happens nowadays, they don't say, what does the church think? No. It's what scientists think, what business think, what government thinks. And also, if some priest wants to talk, or some minister or rabbi wants to talk, they will listen. But it's only... Now, that's the composition of the modern world. Every nation we know, even China itself, divides falls into that family. That's number one characteristic of the New World Order, that religion has become just one of the non-governmental organizations competing in the marketplace for popularity and for adherence. The second characteristic is this, that nowadays no nation, and this is the chiefest effect of the New World Order, no nation can survive unless it shares in the globalized money. What does that mean? It means that the daily flow of capital and the flow of capital goods is regulated by global rules. And if you don't share in that, you perish. For instance, what happened in North Korea? Do you remember 5-6 years ago, they were threatening to lob missiles at us. Now what they're doing, they're knocking at the door. They're hungry because they don't belong to international trade. They're just beginning to realize that they can't sell or buy anywhere. And they're starving, by the way. The South Korea is now giving food to the North Koreans.
Now, this is a change because we can remember in the 1930s how Stalin built his socialism in one country.
Sure.
That doesn't seem to be the program today, because like even the Chinese communists have integrated themselves into the world economy.
And they are trading and buying and selling to billions, to the tune of billions on both sides. At first, like Albania. Albania said, no, we're communists. Now they're in complete chaos because they tried to stay outside. Now they're no longer outside, they're nowhere, they're in chaos.
Now,
so the point I'm making is that no country can live, can subsist today, unless it belongs to the global rules. And one of the global rules is that the flow of capital and the flow of capital goods produced by capital, you must participate in that, or else, buddy, you are for the grave.
Now, does that mean that communism is dead? Let's say like that in China, they now have elements of market economy?
Communism is dead. Marxism is not, as a method of thought. Marxism is not, as a method of thought.
So Marxism is more than just a command-style economy.
It's an ideology. It's an ideology. And it's basically this. Its main tenets are so simple. Man is an animal, a highly organized animal, period. Nothing more, number one. Number two, there's only this life. There's only matter. Smells, sounds, sights, dimensions. That's all there is. And thirdly, the state is finally the most powerful organ. And that's what's happened. The government in every country is far more important than it ever was before. And in this country, the same thing. And we can't get rid of the government any longer.
So the central organizing principle, let's say, of Marxism, never was a centrally controlled economy. It was a this-worldly mentality.
That's right. That's what Marx was building on.
And so, let's say, Chinese communism has undergone, let's say, a metamorphosis.
Sure it has. And they now have one whole area which is thoroughly capitalistic. And, for instance, there are Chinese returning and building houses in Shanghai. They're millionaires. There's no difficulty. The Chinese are very practical. And just is to make money. Now, what they do maintain is government control of the masses, because then they have cheap labor. They have cheap labor. And they can kill as many babies as they want to and keep the population down. It's already 1 billion point something. So they can do all that. But that's Marxism, not communism. Communism is a joke. Nobody ever prospered under communism. The Soviet Union collapsed, imploded because of communism. And it's created havoc in all these countries, Romania, Bulgaria, Czechoslovakia, and East Germany. They were in ruins, and Poland, at the end of their communist life.
But here's a question I have. If, let's say, the what is officially the Communist Party of China has adopted a market economy,
sure,
and we in the West have adopted a this-worldly view and implemented, let's say, a liberal abortion policy,
yes, yes.
What difference is there between us and them?
None. None, except we have more liberal laws, and we have a system of justice which is more liberal, certainly as regards the criminal.
But these are differences of degree, not of kind.
No difference in kind. I'm sorry. Now, we have more tolerance here, less and less, by the way, for churches, for religions. We have less and less stuff.
So there is, let's say, a capital that has been built up over the Christian centuries that we're now living off, and this still has, let's say, a positive influence in countries like America and Canada and Great Britain.
A little, only a little. What you're really saying, Bernard, if you think, you're saying there's convergence.
Yes.
We're converging finally to the same system. And by the way, George Shultz went with who it was, Ronnie Reagan, to Moscow in the 1980s, and they wrote down that they composed the famous cultural agreement, which means that what they're laboring now in Moscow and in New York, the Carnegie Endowment for the humanities here, and then a thing called Informatik in Moscow, they are producing the same textbooks for children in Russia, as here, as in Borneo, as in Latin America, as everywhere, only the language will be different. So children will learn the same things everywhere, and there'll be homogeneity.
Now, this is a point I want to stop at right here, because it seems like the globalists, what they want to do is to level or snuff out kind of the local particularisms of any kind.
That's right. That's right. And you see, here's the terrible thing for Americans when they realize it, which is not yet, there will come a time, shortly, when laws affecting their salaries, the place they live, their housing, their taxes, their travels, their family, will be made by non-Americans.
Isn't this actually the issue that got Margaret Thatcher so furious towards the end of her rule as Prime Minister, the fact that more and more British sovereignty was passing into the hands of the European Union.
Was being eroded and passed on into the European Union. That's what now makes the big opposition in Britain. They know that when they enter the European Union, when they have monetary union in 1999, that is the end of Britain as they know it. So much so, Bernard, I think there are going to be big resistance to this European Union at the last moment. They may have to enter it, and they may go under, be submerged, and it'll be the end of England as we have known it. But to revert to the situation with the New World Order, Americans will find this out too late, and they can't do anything about it. What can we do when the laws are made by others? And, for instance, the new NAFTA agreement affects jobs here. Can we do anything about it? No, sir. And the World Trade Organization, of which we're signatories, are going to make laws about world trade that will affect our jobs and our money and our dollar and our salaries. We can't do anything about it. We are caught in it. There's no escaping this. We're in the New World Order. Now, here's the point. Do you remember we spoke about the advances in the medical field, the health field, and the development of abortion and contraception as a means of accustoming people to another way of looking at the human body and the development of the human frame, and finally the goal of having the subhuman culture? That's all part of the same system. Create a paradise on earth for the elite. Period.
Now, the argument has been that what we would have is a global economy, but that culture would be decided locally. But when I, let's say, pick up the papers and read, let's say, about your home country of Ireland,
right,
it seems like the same pressure is causing the Irish culture to break down. They now are passing laws opening up abortion and divorce.
Absolutely. And it's that. And the culture is... The ancient culture, the Christian culture, is being eroded. There's no doubt about that. It's being eroded. For instance, there's a thing called river dance. I don't know if you've seen it. It's the Irish dance. And it's the first time the Irish have produced something which has no religious aspect. It's based on myth, and it's based on pagan myth, and it's based on pagan belief. But if you haven't come across it, it's something else. So the culture is being eroded and replaced with this new culture.
But doesn't this new culture kind of create what you had very much in the Soviet Union, kind of a drabness?
Of course it does. Of course it does. And people are getting bored with it. There are more suicides, and people are revolting against it. But we can't do anything about it, Bernard. Whether we like it or not, we're walking into it. And we're going to be subjected to the same godless, sometimes pornographic, television and amusement. There'll be no mention of God. There'll be no mention of eternal life. There's no mention of religion. That's the transcendent view that's excluded from the public square in America, according to the Supreme Court. And that's the New World Order. Now, what's going to happen? Well, Is it going to go hunky-dory like that, and will we finally find ourselves faced with the faceless state government making laws that we can't disobey and that confine us and really erode our religion? No, it won't go like that. It will not go through, because we have a solemn promise that God so loved this world that he sent his only begotten Son in order to save it. And we have also the promises of Our Lady and several big occasions at La Salette in France in 1846, because we're an old religion, and at Fatima in 1917, and at Garabandal in 1963. Those three alone tell us that God is going to step in and chastise this world and punish it for killing 500 million babies a year, and for oppressing and for shedding of blood and for starving people and inciting wars, and finally destroying the innocence of youth with pornography. God's going to step in, and step in soon. And nobody that I know of any stature at all in the church today or in religion thinks it's going to come in 200 years' time. It's around the corner. It's coming fast.
Now, is this why, and you talked about this, I think that was the very first scene in Windswept House, mm-hmm. in 1957, when the dignitaries of six first countries of the, at that time it was the European Economic Community,
yeah.
Met with the Pope, that the Pope, Pius XII, foresaw that they would have their day, but it would only be a day.
It's only a day. It's only a day, because God is in his heaven. And Bernard, I hate making predictions, because human predictions are so fallible. But, and I may not live, I'm 76, I may not live long enough to see this, but I know that within a short time, you, a young man, will see the hand of God punishing the world around you. And you included, because you're part of the world. And your family too.
Now, here is an issue that I would like to raise, and that's that there seems like, and you've alluded to this already in our conversations, that there is no escape. There's no place in the world that I can, let's say, move to and escape all the problems.
You can now, there are several communities, one in Idaho, one in Kansas City, St. Joseph's, Kansas, and in various other places, and in Canada, there are a few mentioned to me now and again in conversations, but they won't save you. They won't save anybody.
So it's not possible to entirely freeze out the world?
No. If you go down to the Pampas in Argentina, if you travel to the Gobi Desert, if you go anywhere, it's going to come after you, because the whole world is entrailed in it. And then, as far as we know, the best judgment is that the chastisement is going to affect everybody, whether you live in the middle of the Gobi Desert, or in Kathmandu, Nepal, or on the pampas of Argentina, or hide beneath the ocean in a bubble, it will still get to you.
Now, isn't there an unfairness here? Because, let's say, many families and good priests have done their best and led virtuous lives, and yet they're going to suffer from this that was caused, the immorality of other people.
Sure, but remember when Christ was on his way to Calvary and the women were crying over him, crying over his pains and his torture. And he said, don't cry for me, because I'm just the green wood. You're the dry. Cry for yourselves and your children. There's a law there which is funny. For instance, if you and I get married, and if you're a lush, a woman who's a drunk, and I'm a cocaine addict, and you conceive, the baby is going to be alcoholic probably, and it's going to have AIDS, if I have AIDS, or one of us have AIDS. Why doesn't God save the baby? Punish us, but why not? He doesn't save the baby. And if when Adam and Eve ate that apple or whatever they ate, why did he punish me? I didn't eat the apple. He has this law. And as the Bible says, the fathers ate sour grapes, but the children's teeth are blood. In other words, the children are punished for what the fathers did. And that's God's law.
So God's law, and this is a theme too that emerged from Windswept House, is that there is salvation through suffering.
That's right. There's salvation through suffering, but there will be suffering caused by the sins of others. And the typical example is the baby who was aborted by its mother or its father. I mean, well, it did nothing to merit such awful torture. but yet he's punished. Why doesn't God allow it? Why doesn't he punish the parents? He doesn't. It's the baby. He punishes the parents later. But the baby suffers the dire pains of having an evil father and an evil mother. Similarly, war, I mean, there must be a little killed in the last war, in the Second World War, that weren't, had no dealing with this, and they had nothing to do with it at all. That's God's law. And it started with Adam and Eve. And by the way, we can all have a conversation with Adam and Eve later on. By the way, the church never called them Saint Adam or Saint Eve. Have you ever noticed that? Churches say Saint Abraham is a saint, and David is a saint, and Isaiah is a saint, and Jeremiah is a saint, but Adam and Eve are never described as saints. Ever. Because I think we have a bone, a crow to pluck with them, or a bone to pick with them. Because they did let us down. And because they did what they did, you and I are in our present quandary today, the possibility of going to hell. We wouldn't be here if it weren't for them. So don't grumble at me, it's unfair. Of course it's unfair, but you see, when you get to that region of unfairness, we have no rights. God is God.
And maybe he's trying to tell us that to build an earthly paradise just isn't possible.
He never destined this. He never wanted this. And Christ himself said to the apostles in that Last Supper, he said, but now it's the hour of the prince of this world and the hours of the powers of darkness, but he has nothing in on me. He has no power over me. It's totally independent of the world and of the prince of this world. And that's why it's grieving. It's very grievous. And it grieves me an awful lot to find people talking about building a paradise and building a habitat for men and women and establishing universal fraternity and brotherhood. That's fine and dandy if you want to do that politically, but that's not the work of salvation. The work of salvation is, you're a mortal sin, I'm going to forgive your sins. You're dying, I'm going to shrive you so that you go straight to heaven. That's what I can promise you. Nothing else. Nothing else.
So the problems in this life that, let's say, might flow out of this New World Order is just crosses, again, that good Catholics have to bear.
That's right. That's right. And be the butt, because we are the enemies. We're the only enemies. Because if they get rid of us, if they got rid of the Catholic Church, which they won't, then all other religions would collapse. There'd be no reason. Nobody would subsist. No Christian religion would start, but it would continue, and no Judaism would succeed. It would be all over. And the sacrament of the Mass would stop. There would no longer be a blessed sacrament, no chapel, no worship, and the eternal sacrifice the prophet Malachi speaks about would have ceased, and the world would come to an end. So we are essential, and Lucifer knows that. And he knows too he's going to be beaten, but he's doing his damnedest, as they say, to take as many with him. He doesn't take prisoners.
Now, the focus of Windswept House was the Holy Father.
That's right.
Is that one of the key elements of this Luciferian movement of building the New World Order, is to gain some measure of control over the papacy?
Bernard, correct that statement, to gain total control. Total control. Because if you don't have total control over the papacy, just partial control of part of the papal government, the other part is going to go against you. You must control it completely. And there are two ways of control. Either I control it because I give you direct orders and you fulfill them, or I make it in such a way that you fulfill my will, my commands, without knowing it.
And that's perhaps the situation, the second scenario is perhaps the situation then that we have today.
For the majority. They think they're okay. They think it's fine. But some of them have lost the faith. Others are weak. And they don't want to go against the grain. They don't want to stand up and be counted. They don't want to rock the boat. I know middle of the road, Monsignore and bishops, good priests who never soil their soul. Never religion, never committed sins really, are just and good, but they won't do anything. They will go along with anything that's proposed. And that I think is as bad as the person who fulfills the evil commands of Lucifer. I think it's just as bad. You're permitting things to happen.
These are the lukewarm souls we're talking about.
Yes,
here.
And the first The first curse in the apocalypse is, because you're neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. That's the first comment of the church.
And that's why we're called to be a church militant.
That's right. That's right. But tell me, where is that militancy today? Where is there any evangelistic fervor? Where is there a missionary effort? Where is there apostolicity and fervor and let's go do it, let's get moved? It doesn't exist. Where? Tell me about it. Do you see it anywhere? It's nowhere. That spirit has died out. It's now a question of compromise. And, for instance, the present Pope has signed an agreement with the Orthodox churches that he will forbid all proselytism. You can't try to convert a Russian or a Greek now. You're forbidden by the Pope. That, I mean, come on. Now you're not supposed to try and convert Jews. That's also being frowned upon, because that offends our Jewish brothers. And their covenant is as valid as our covenant with God. So the doctrine goes. And that's the end of the missionary church. But, you know, our condition is such that we need to have missions to ourselves, because we are fading fast in our ordinary liturgy, our ordinary prayer, our ordinary asceticism. And while there's a small handful getting better and better, getting more and more holy, getting more and more divine in their behavior, the majority of Catholics are being led out of the church by the nose, and they don't know it. They don't know it. They think it's okay. And I, as a priest, I meet them every day of the week in America. And they think everything is fine until you start pointing out certain things, and they suddenly say, yeah, that's funny, that's no good. And then you hope that it's only a conversation of 5 minutes or 10 minutes or an hour. You hope that later on it will bear fruit. But most of them find it's too difficult to go against the grain. How can they go up to their pastor and say, you're teaching heresy, or you're not teaching the truth? They're not going to do that. The pastor will say, you're an ignoramus. I did my theology. I'm a priest. I have authority from the bishop and the pope.
Well, I've known many laity who have gone, let's say, to the bishop, to the priest, and pointed out errors, and it does nothing.
No, no.
So they end up just walking out of the parish.
The terrible thing, Bernard, is this, that today it's not an isolated case. This is universal. This is universal. There's a universal laxity, there's a universally practiced permissiveness about sexual morality of your children. What mother is going to expel her son because he brings home his girlfriend to go to bed with him, or vice versa, a daughter bring back a boyfriend? No, they won't fight it. And they're all over the place. And they're good people. They wouldn't do it themselves, but they won't correct the children, because they're afraid of losing the children. And similarly with all other practices. So there's a general permission, and the priest says, well, you've got to help them along, they're young. And he doesn't enforce the rule, he doesn't preach against abortion. When is the last time you heard a sermon against abortion, or against contraception, or against homosexuality? You don't hear them nowadays. Because it isn't fair, it isn't democratic.
Now, isn't that a theme too of Windswept House, is just there kind of is an atmosphere now of weakness and acquiescence?
That's right. Just weakness and acquiescence, and that's considered to be noble. It's considered to be American. It's considered to be democratic. It's considered to be good, to be normal, and not to be crabby and confined and prejudiced and be judgmental. You're not judgmental at all. You're not supposed to be judgmental. You don't judge anybody. That is the attitude today, and that's the new world order for you. That's the attitude of the new world order. And the laws help that.
Now, a subject that I'd like to move to next is this Pope, because it's in Windswept House, it was the plot revolves around the resignation protocol. Why is it that some of the cardinals wanted to push the Pope out, and is this actually the case in reality?
Well, here's the point. This Pope is a Pole. And while he is very permissive in certain things, ecumenism, for instance, he is absolutely against any let-up of the church ban on abortion, contraception, masturbation, divorce and remarriage. He won't touch those things. No let up at all.
So he is a barrier against implementing this new moral order.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, several authorities, including cardinals, have said that we have to change our laws about abortion and contraception and divorce and remarriage. We must experiment. Further, they want to experiment with women priests, and this Pope says no. And they want to experiment with married priests, and this Pope says no, not in the Latin Rite part of the Church anyway, not in the Western part of the Church. For other parts, yes. On the other hand, the Luciferians have a very tight schedule. They have an inner Luciferian prophecy that says that unless the prince is properly installed in the citadel, namely the Church, the Vatican, by 1999, they've lost. But in order to install him completely, to complete the enthronement, they have to get rid of this Pope. Now, how do you get rid of a Pope? Well, you kill him, or you get him to resign, or he dies. Now, they're not going to kill him, because it's too mucky, and then there's no such thing as a secret. We now know who killed the other popes, and we know why they did, and there's no such thing as a secret. It always leaks out, and they don't want this to be on their
mind. They don't want it to backfire on them.
That's right, and it would. It was a paper which said, look, under these circumstances, the Pope should resign or be resigned. That was what the paper said. He wrote back and modified certain things, and finally he decided to get out of the whole difficulty by writing his own document about papal resignation, and he did. He composed a motu proprio. Now, a motu proprio is the Latin Roman term for what we call an executive order. When the president issues an executive order, nobody can disobey it. Every organ of government must obey it.
Talking about how the modernists in the Vatican want to push Pope John Paul II into resignation because they feel that his strong stand on moral values such as abortion and artificial contraception is blocking the coming of this new order that they're so much in favor of. And at the same time, we have a situation where many traditional Catholics are very disappointed in this Pope for reasons of his, let's say, as you've mentioned, ecumenism, lack of governance. This is a very, for many people, confusing and contradictory situation. And in the book, Windswept House, there were many discussions, let's say, between Father Gladstone and Father Slattery, and Father Gladstone and Father Carnesecca. Are these kind of discussions what are going on in the minds of many Catholics?
Yes. Most of those conversations, most of them, not all of them, most of the conversations are recorded ones I've had or listened into with my friends. Priests in Rome when I went there, and priests here, and priests in France. And in England. These are the subjects that came up all this. They were always discussed, sometimes virulently, sometimes angrily. People were either for or against. So there are conversations that take place, that took place in my presence.
So between people and also sometimes maybe within the minds of one individual. I have a hard time sometimes making out this.
Yeah, well, mostly they were based... in fact, I think every conversation there is based on a conversation I listened to. I was privy to...
Yes, and I've certainly encountered these kinds of conversations many, many
sure.
times, because it seems that the point that's causing Catholics the most difficulty now is that of this Holy Father.
It is the big stumbling block. And people fall into two or three categories. They either say, well, he's Holy Father, we don't understand why he does this, we think that that he's doing his best, and we'll understand later. Others say, no, he's wrong, he ceased to be Pope, we no longer owe him allegiance. And others say, it doesn't matter. He's Pope, and that's all that counts. So between the two of them, it's very hard to... Between the three of them, it's very hard to know what to do. Bernard, in this matter of the Holy Father, there's no doubt about it, there are things that we find very hard to understand or even to reconcile with Catholic faith. There are very hard things to reconcile. What is my attitude? My attitude is this. I'm not allowed to judge my Pope. Canon law forbids anybody to judge the Pope. Someday, the Church will infallibly pronounce a judgment on every Pope, especially on this Pope, because he's a key Pope. He's at a key moment in Church history. He has a key power to wield. He's wielding it in one direction, which I think is wrong, but I'm only a single Catholic and he's Pope. And I'm not in the catbird seat. I don't know what he knows that makes him act as he does. I pray for him, and I will continue to honor him and defend him as my Pope. I will not agree with him when he teaches me something that goes against what I've been taught.
And a Catholic need not follow something that, let's say, goes against the faith, let's say, like, or the traditions of the Church, let's say, like his ecumenism.
No need whatever. In fact, you shouldn't. St. Thomas and all the saints say, if a bishop or a pope teaches something which you know from your tradition, from your teaching, from your catechism, from your parents, from your school, from your church, is not what the Church has taught, you have no reason to follow it. You can say, no, Holy Father, I won't accept that, and still be a loyal Catholic. In fact, you are bound to do that for the sake of truth. You're bound to. The idea that when a Pope says something, that says you can't open your mouth, that's not Catholicism at all. So that's my attitude to John Paul II. I have severe difficulties with a lot he has done and a lot he does. I have severe difficulties with a lot of things he says he believes. I can't believe them because my tradition in the Catholic Church says, no, that's not correct. For instance, my tradition tells me that Christ descended into the underworld to leave the souls in limbo. He denies that. I have to follow that creed. It's a part of the creed. He descended into hell, in inferos. That's the old Latin. It means hell or means the underworld. I can't accept that from him. He says that Martin Luther was a very good man, a great, profound religious thinker. I can't accept that. I think he was a pig, and he's a blasphemer, and I think he's in hell. Frankly, I just can't accept those things. But that doesn't mean the Pope is wrong or is bad or ceases to be Pope. It means I can't accept it, and I'm not bound to accept it. So can't one be reasonably differ from the Pope and yet be a good Catholic? Of course one can.
Now, a lot of people too have difficulty understanding just what is his strategy, and I think you've mentioned in the past that for the first 10 years or so of his pontificate, wasn't it directed towards a geopolitical strategy of bringing down the Iron Curtain?
Yes, it was. Up to 1981, he was persuaded that he had a long reign in front of him and that solution of problems was at a long, long range. Then he was shot. And as you know, when he lay in Gemelli Hospital in Rome, he had a vision. He had the Fatima vision. He saw it. God revealed it to him. He saw the whole thing. And he suddenly sent for his personal secretary and got the copy of The Secret, which he hadn't studied, and read it. And then he called a famous nun, a very well-known nun who was an expert on Fatima, and sent her to Portugal to talk with Sister Lucia. And when he came out, it was quite obvious that he had another geopolitical purpose in mind. He now knew that he wasn't going to live for a long time, and his papacy wouldn't last a long time. He also knew that Russia was finished, that the Soviet Union was finished, but that Russia wasn't. And he set out, therefore, to exercise as much geopolitical influence as he could. But, you see, there was a flaw in his armor. And the flaw was this. He had won through a thing called solidarity. Do you remember the Solidarity organization?
Yes, that was headed by Lech Walesa.
Lech Walesa. Solidarność. The difficulty is this, the Solidarność was a purely secular movement. Purely secular. There's nothing wrong with it, but it's purely secular. Nothing religious. And he cut his teeth on that organization. That's how they defeated the Stalinists in Poland. That's how they brought Edmund Gierek, the premier, down with the whole government. They were on their knees to him and Cardinal Wyszyński for help, keep the country safe from the Russians, from the Soviets. When he then started his geopolitics, he still relied on secular organization. He wasn't acting merely and simply through faith, the arms of faith. No, he was doing politics, and it was the geopolitics of reason, not the geopolitics of faith. And by 1989-90, he had become totally immersed in geopolitics of reason. And he was a great friend of Gorbachev's, and he had become very close to the Americans, and he relied on secular movements to bring about spiritual ends. And it didn't happen. It only got worse.
So, they did succeed in bringing down the Iron Curtain.
No doubt about it.
But it didn't have the fruits that he had, spiritual fruits that he had hoped for.
No, it hadn't. Because, you see, he made a mistake. The same mistake as Paul VI made, and same as John XXIII made. And Bernard, I have asked myself again and again, why the three popes made this mistake. The Queen of Heaven gave a mandate. She said, consecrate Russia to me on one day, all you bishops, together, and Russia will be converted to Catholicism. I mean, it wasn't merely converted, it would become Catholic, and Marxism will be finished. And there'll be no chastisements. If you don't do that, my son is going to punish you all. And John XXIII and Paul VI and John Paul II, all three neglected this. John the 23rd said, the children didn't know what they were saying. They thought Russia was a whore in the streets of Lisbon. And anyway, I'm talking with Nikita Khrushchev, this is 1962, he will allow observers to come to my Vatican Council if I don't condemn Marxism. And therefore John Luther didn't allow the fathers of the council to condemn Marxism. And he certainly would not publish he said, we will not publish this letter ever. It will never be published. And I will not consecrate Russia. Because if I did that, Nikita Khrushchev would know, and he'd consider it an act of war. All the bishops, Catholic bishops, gathered in a place, 2,700 of them in the Vatican, and they condemn Russian Marxism, Soviet Marxism. Come on, it's war. There's going to be persecution. That's John XXIII's reason. Paul VI simply was afraid of his own shadow, and besides, he didn't believe in Fatima. John Paul II sort of believed in Fatima, sort of. He didn't quite believe in Fatima. And he decided that he couldn't do it because he wasn't the Pope of 1960. And Lucy had originally said the Pope of 1960 must do the consecration. So he did nothing about it. In fact, he permitted the suppression of Sister Lucia, and permitted the suppression of the message of Fatima to a large extent throughout the church, because his Secretary of State, Casaroli, who is an atheist as far as I'm concerned, he exercised himself as Secretary of State through all Vatican representatives to suppress Fatima as much as possible. For instance, the apostolic delegates in Lisbon and his entire staff were very favorable to Fatima. Casaroli changed them all and put in somebody who was not sympathetic. And so on and went on like that. So why is it that these three popes, the last three popes, refused? And when John Paul II was asked to now consecrate Russia, no, all he could do was kneel in St. Peter's Square, and in the middle of a consecration of the human race, the Immaculate Heart of Mary, he said, and also we consecrate to her care the people who are awaiting their consecration to her Immaculate Heart. What sort of gobbledygook is that? For me, that's gobbledygook, and disgusts me on John Paul II's lips. He's supposedly a knight of the Immaculate Queen. He's supposedly a member of Maximilian Kolbe's group of knights fighting, and he wouldn't do this. So, I mean, I think it all goes back to Lucifer. He just has too much power within the prelacy of the church, within the organization. He's able to squeeze everybody who attempts that thing.
And so Lucifer has paralyzed whatever efforts there have been, let's say, to do what the Mother of God actually wanted.
Yeah, this is the Queen of Heaven. And even if John 23rd said Nikita Khrushchev will declare war on us, he can say, well, you want this done, you must have some plan. Trust. No trust. So I think it is clear to me that the will of Christ is that these three popes should destroy the organization of the church, which they have. They've destroyed the organization. They've been instrumental. And they will answer for it. And in the case of John Paul II, and John 23rd, and Paul VI, it's malfeasance in high office. They're not supposed to do that. They're supposed to take care of that. They didn't.
So to get back then to the original question, the reason why John Paul II's geopolitical strategy ultimately failed to bring, let's say, the spiritual fruits that he would have wanted is because he used the methods that weren't prescribed by Our Lady.
That's right. That's why he wasn't relying on purely spiritual means. Purely spiritual means. And he didn't do what she said. She said, consecrate Russia to my Immaculate Heart, all you bishops, on the same day, using the same formula if possible. Do it. And publish this secret to the world. Publish the secret. No, we won't publish the secret ever, they say now. And John Paul II said from the beginning, we will not publish it.
Now, since the fall of the Iron Curtain, has Pope John Paul II actually had a coherent strategy for dealing, let's say, with the problems in the church and in the world?
No, he has not had a coherent strategy because, we all forget, you always forget this, Bernard, he is the head of a bureaucracy, a very talented bureaucracy. And its biggest source of talent is the Secretary of State. Now, the Secretary of State is divided into two sections. One deals with bishops, and the second one, the second part of it, deals with secular governments. By the way, they're experts. There are no doubt about it, the Vatican people know what they're doing. And their information is legendary. They have information on a 24-hour basis. They have a source of information that the American government or the CIA or the Mossad or the KGB haven't got. But they must implement a Pope's policy, and they are dead set against Pope John Paul II's geopolitics. They don't agree with him. They frustrated him, and they frustrate him. And now it's too late. They frustrated him because they have their own ambitions. Why? Because they're thoroughly penetrated with masonry.
So there are masons right in the Vatican?
Oh, yes. That's the difficulty. That's the big difficulty. We've been penetrated. The barbarians are in the streets of the city. They're not outside the door. They're outside the walls. They're in charge. And John Paul II has realized that he can't move hand or foot unless he was strong enough to take out an axe and cut off heads. But he can't lift an axe any longer. He can't cut off any heads. He is dying. This is July. This is March 22. Our Pope, John Paul II, is dying on his feet. For sure he's dying. It's not the dying that I'm 76, and I suppose in a certain sense my body is dying because it ceased to grow. But I'm not dying in the sense he is actually dying. You can measure it week by week, his weakness, the way he shuffles, the way he grunts instead of talking, the way he can't shake hands, he can't look at you in the eye, he can't bend. He shuffles along the ground, he doesn't walk. He slumps into a chair, he doesn't sit down and stand up. He's helped out of a chair and he slumps back into it. He's dying, literally. And we know it, everybody knows it, but the Vatican has covered it all up. Has he got Parkinson's disease? Has. He got Parkinson's disease. It's like saying, have I got a bloodstream? He had that for a long time. So he's dying, and he can't do anything about it. And now he has all the ghosts of the past coming at him, and he's all the ghosts of the present moment, and all the specters of unsolved problems and his judgment is gone awry. I mean, he receives Fidel Castro and Gorbachev in the same 36 hours and honors them. You don't honor people of that nature. If you have to talk to them, you talk to them very privately, and you send it to a Monsignore or a bishop, of which he has many. You don't honor them with a papal visit.
Now, you just mentioned Gorbachev, and the book Windswept House spoke a lot about Russia. Mm-hmm. Does Russia still play an important role in the message of Fatima, even though the Iron Curtain has come down?
It does. It does. And I said to you, and I think it's true, that there's some unfinished chapter or paragraph in John Paul II's life before he dies in connection with Russia. His destiny is tied with Kiev in Ukraine and with Moscow. Why, I don't know, but I know this much. That's what he has told me, and I believe it. There's something connected there. Now, as regards the message of Fatima, it still stands. It still stands. The errors of Russia are now abroad, and they are abroad. Russia will be converted, finally, by my Immaculate Heart, she said. It will be, she said it. But a bit late, but not too late, she said. So Russia is within the plan. Why? That would take me too far afield into papal secrets. Why Russia and Kiev are involved in the final solution of this problem. But they are. They're part and parcel. And it's really God's choice. It's purely and simply God's choice, like he chose the Jews to bring his son into the world through them. He makes choices. He has his own favorite solutions for things. I wouldn't have chosen the Russians, or Kiev, or the East for salvation, but salvation is to come from the East for us all. And John Paul II is inevitably tied into it. His great pain is that he failed, and he did fail.
Now, we've discussed Russia. I'd also like to, because most of our listeners are Americans, I would like to discuss a little bit about the role of the United States and the other Anglo-Saxon nations, Canada, Australia, Great Britain, New Zealand, in the whole picture. And that's another thing that sometimes came out in Windswept House, is that the let's say Italian-based cardinals would refer to the Anglo-Saxons. What role do the Anglo-Saxon nations play in the church and to do with Rome?
Well, it may seem a contradiction to you or to many people. The biggest role the Anglo-Saxon nations are playing and will play as regards the Church of Rome is as follows. The Anglo-Saxons have been the source and the creators of the Lodge, starting with the Scottish Lodge. The Lodge is something in which hides the only enemies of the truth on the face of this earth. And in their upper reaches, 33rd degree and beyond, the carefulest plans for destruction of the Roman Catholic Church as a church, not as an organization, they wanted to go on. Those plans have been laid there. And the Anglo-Saxons are the ones that pursue it. They're the ones that are the seedbed of it all. That's very important for the Roman Catholic Church. Now, there are some fervent Catholics in England, and there are some fervent Catholics in the United States, and in New Zealand, and in Ireland, and in Australia. But the importance as regards the Anglo-Saxons and Rome is this antipathy, this polar opposite. That's how things have lined up. And the big Masonic influence against the Roman Catholic Church, against faith, against the supernatural, against the whole mission of Christ, comes from only from the Masons. But now, I'm not talking about the Shriners, the men you see with the little caps, with the little feathers, and having celebrations every year, or the Elks. No, that's I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the real basic brotherhood of Masons, who have as a life's aim to eliminate supernatural in Roman Catholicism and use the organization for humanitarian purposes. They have a prophecy to that effect. made in the 18th century. And now, they're strictly following that.
Now, there's another factor, too. During the Cold War, the United States and the Vatican, and also the United States' Anglo-Saxon allies, found themselves on the same side in opposing atheistic communism. Now it seems that the policies of the American government and the Vatican are at odds, because isn't the United States now, especially with some of the most recent bills that have cleared the House of Representatives and the Senate, isn't the United States government pushing population control, which runs diametrically opposed to the Vatican's agenda?
Absolutely. There's a direct clash there between the two of them, and we now are committed to limiting the population of about 15 countries. We've named them, and there's an executive order signed by every nation, every president, since Dick Nixon, ordering the spreading of sterilization, abortion, and contraceptive methods for these nations as a security threat to the United States, as dire a threat to us as our nuclear bombs. See, they call now the, it is called in this document, it's a famous document, 200 in SFM, they call it a strategic necessity. In the language of diplomacy, a strategic necessity is something which is necessary for my survival as a nation. And we must have nuclear weapons for the survival of our nation. We must also sterilize, abort, and contracept for the security of the United States, according to the executive order. It's as bad as that. And we contribute in a minimum of $5 billion a year abroad for this. We're not talking about what's done at home. That's a different fund. But we contribute at least $5 billion abroad, and we push it. And every organ of government of the United States government is supposed to join it, whether it's the Minister of the Interior or whether it's the Department of Commerce, no matter what it is, they all must contribute to this fight against population control.
Now, is there an underlying spiritual or Luciferian reason why this limit the population agenda is being promoted? Because strictly from a scientific or economic viewpoint, there's no necessity. Because I know of various programs both in Canada and the United States that actually pay farmers not to grow wheat because there's so much of a surplus.
It doesn't make sense. What does make sense is the following. First of all, the slaughter of human beings. Do you remember what the Carthaginians used to do outside of Carthage? They had this mound, this hill, and there was a perpetual fire there, maintained by the priests of Moloch, and every morning the women would take their newborn babies and burnt them. That was Carthage. Well, instead of the devil having that amount of worship by killing innocent babies, we now have, 300 million a year all over the world wide, babies that are killed every day, every year?
Through abortion,
yeah. And abortifacient and contraceptives. Don't forget that. Many children are killed in the womb by contraceptives that are abortifacient.
And is this...
The point I'm making to you, but not to interrupt you, is this. The point I'm making to you is this, that it satisfied the devil's desire to kill off human beings without baptism.
So really then, the agenda is to keep souls out of heaven then?
That's away from God's grasp. Away from him. He made them and he loved them and he wants them, but he can't have them because they're going to die without baptism. I think God has his own solution for that problem. That's number one benefit of it. Number two benefit of it is that it also it means that those against the church are going to have power to limit the church's ambit and reduce its teaching and wipe it out as a supernaturally inclined organization. So it's a double whammy, and it's succeeding. It's succeeding because more Catholics now practice contraception than don't.
And is pressure coming down, let's say, upon the minority of Christian families, let's say, of various denominations who have large families?
Absolutely. Not to have large families. After two children, the pressure is always on them. And we now know that, 62% of all two children Catholic families have undergone either vasectomy or fallopian tubes tying up. effectively sterilization, effectively, but it's private. But 62% of them have. So when you see a family of two children only, you can be, I think, about 80% sure that it's deliberate. They've sterilized each other, or that one of them has been sterilized. So they wouldn't have any more children. Because it's not chic, it's not social, it's not environmental, it's not American, it's not socially beneficial, you're not being mainstream.
In this interview with Father Malachi Martin, we are going to talk about how the New World Order and the New Church are impacting your average family, your average parish priest, and maybe some of the tactics or strategies that they can employ for coping with it. First of all, I'd like to ask, is the situation such now that there's no escape from this New World Order? Can one, let's say, move from one part of the country to another part of the country to get away from the problems?
Well, Bernard, you might get away from the problems locally and for a while from the general problems, but they're going to catch up with you. You can't get away from it, especially if you're any sort of a practicing Catholic, because wherever you go, whatever church you go to, it's going to be embroiled in one or another of the divisive factions that now separate us. We should touch on this, why it's there. We must go into detail about some of them. So the first thing, really, my counsel is to you and to anybody else, is know what is happening. If I ask the normal Catholic who's really observant and saying their rosary beads and going to Mass and communion, confession regularly, and who have respect for the clergy and for the Pope, you know, good Catholics, and are rearing their children as best they can, they give you the impression when they talk that what's really is happening is this, that the church is there, of course. But you have this nasty crowd of people who are corrupt, and they're attacking the church, and they go away finally. And things will right themselves, and people will get more and more reverent, and schools will improve, and we'll get back finally to something like Catholic life, and have a Catholic community, because we've no Catholic community now, they'll tell you, and they haven't. There's no such thing as a Catholic community. That's for a lot of people have that attitude. The news is more dire than that, but it's better, if that's possible. First of all, the main news is this. It's not going to stop. We're heading downward, but the question is into what? Into what? And there's no doubt about it, we're going to see further disruption of Catholic life. We're going to see new manifestations of Catholic vigor in a minor way in isolated communities. We're going to see no big national or international Catholic resurgence. None. Not in my lifetime, not in yours, and you're a young man, but it won't be. We're heading into something else. We're heading into a period of the end, really. You can define it two ways. It's the end of Catholic times, and it's the beginning of pagan times. End of Catholic times means that the influence, the political, cultural, social, religious influence of the Church of Rome is at an end and will shortly die, and will be only admitted insofar as the influence of the Mormon Church is admitted, or the influence of the Holy Rollers is admitted, or the Mennonites. We'll just be one of a crowd. Our prestige and our influence is on the way and is going out, and we're shortly going to be reduced in diplomatic power, because, as you know, at the present moment the Pope has 117 embassies on Vatican Hill, 117, and he has 80 of his own representatives in 80 countries. That's all going to be cut down by two-thirds. It's going to disappear completely. And the church will go along with that, because they will say that we must meld into the world and be like everybody else. And they will be like everybody else. That's the curse of it, they'll find out. They will be like everybody else, and not exceptional people, the chosen people of Christ. But that's the first thing to remember, that this is the end of these Catholic times. It's the advent of pagan times. And what we must we mustn't be tantalizingly hypnotized by the fact that there are dire enemies of the church. There are people who want to destroy it, who want to take it over. They want to secularize the whole thing and make it a useful socio-cultural toy for government and for the new world order. That's not what's happening. And there's a parallel that we must draw, and it's this. It's with Christ. If you listened to the normal apostle on Good Friday evening, when he knew Jesus was dead, and he knew he had been bled like a pig, until he had no more blood to lose, and his lungs collapsed, and he collapsed and died with a loud cry, and that he'd been buried in a borrowed tomb by Pal Joseph Arimathea, who was rich, bought the tomb for himself and then gave it to Jesus. What a fate, Joseph Arimathea, and his career was so interesting, and we must touch upon it if we have time, and by Our Lady and Mary Magdalene, the women, the poor, pathetic women around him. Their attitude was, he was a good man, he was our rabbi, he was our leader, he was our teacher. A few of them, like John, believed he was God. Only a few of them, though. They didn't know he was God as such. They knew he was the Messiah. They believed that. Then he was dead. So their attitude was, evil men ganged up on him. Evil men amongst the priests, and they delivered him to the Romans, and the Romans killed him at the behest of the Jewish authorities. It's fundamentally the same paradigm of judgment as it is on the church today. What's happened to the church today is that evil men have ganged up on it and trying to kill it off. And we've got to do something about it. And the disciples, I suppose, gathered in the upper room, hiding by themselves, say, what are we going to do now? The parallel is perfect. But they were wrong. And then there was a scene outside Jerusalem where two disciples decided to get out of it. It was too discouraging. He promised everything. He promised to get rid of the Romans. He promised to found the state of Israel. And he founded it, put them all on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes, and that Israel would be free and the Romans would go away. And their exile and their misery and their pain and their taxation by foreign, the ugly Romans would be all over. And he failed completely. He was captured like a rabbit. In the garden, he's taken, they scourged the life out of him, they made a mockery of him, they sent him over to Herod and they had a big laugh. And they dressed him in a white robe, the white cloth of a madman, and brought him back to Pilate, who said, well, what do you want to do with him? They said, we'll crucify him. Yeah, crucify him. Useless bit of humanity. Why bother about them? And they were going over all this, and they met this stranger walking with them towards the village where they were going for refuge, Emmaus. And they probably had girlfriends in Emmaus or something, relatives. They wanted to get away from Jerusalem. And he was happy. And they said, now what's up with you? He said, well, what's up with you? Why have you got these long faces? And so they said, well, let's talk about this Jesus of Nazareth, a man mighty in power and act. And we thought he was the Messiah. We thought he was going to liberate Israel and chase away the foreigners and make us free again and give us our temple back and give us our... And he said, and they said, he's dead. He's dead, buried. He's been bled like a pig. He's dead. It's all over. And he said to them, have you ever read Moses? I said, yeah, we read the cycle of the year. We read in the synagogue. And you read Isaiah, and you've read Jeremiah, and you've read Ezekiel. You've read them all, haven't you? Well, what do they say about the Messiah? And he went through, one by one, David included the Psalms, and Isaiah, the suffering servant, and Jeremiah about being crucified, and Malachi, the prophet Malachi, went through them all and said, isn't it quite clear that the Messiah had to die? He had to suffer. He had to be disgraced. He had to be put in the tomb, not his. They had to count his bones. They had to pierce his side with a lance. And they had to laugh at him as useless and condemn him. And they said, yeah, that's true. They didn't know what to make, so he said, he pretended to go on. And they said, well, why don't you come have a glass of wine, a bit of bread, because the sun is setting and you can't walk much more, it'll be dark. So he did, and in the breaking of bread, the sacrifice was Jesus. The phrase he used, though, was the important one. It was necessary. It wasn't, the word doesn't mean necessary. It behooved him. It was fitting that he shall die. Now, do you remember when Jesus took Andrew, John, and Peter to the mountain of the Transfiguration Table? And there in front of them, he was transfigured, his raiment, his clothes became white as snow, and he was talking with Moses and Elias. And when they were coming down, they saw all that, and then they felt they were completely overborne by this. They went into a sort of a coma, and they woke up, and he was stirring them and saying, "Wake up, it's all over." And coming down, he said, "No, you tell nobody about this. We're going to Jerusalem, and the high priests and the rulers are going to crucify me." And Peter said, "Crucify you? No, you don't. We've just been talking with God and Moses and Elias, and you want us to think you're going to... Come on." And he said, "You're a devil, Peter. You don't understand the things of man, of God. You're thinking like a man." He used the same phrase as Luke uses in talking about the disciples going to the village of Emmaus. He said, "It behooves me to be crucified. I must be in order to achieve my work. And then I will rule." Similarly with the church.
So the crisis that we're undergoing today is all part of God's plan.
That's right. It behooves us to go under. It behooves us to lose the organization. It is fitting that we go underground. It is fitting that we become laughable and marginalized. It is fitting that we become just hewers of wood and drawers of water.
And we'll understand all why when we go to our judgments then.
That's right. Not until then. No more than the disciples did. The Emmaus disciples did. And they, of course, could run back to Jerusalem and say, "Hey, we just saw him. Forget it. We've seen him too. He's been talking to Magdalene and talking to his mother and talking to everybody else." They had the risen Christ. We still have the risen Christ, but it's in the invisible, behind the veils of the Blessed Sacrament. The point I'm making about the condition of the church is that we can't look on it merely as the evil men have succeeded. They've really eviscerated the church. They've succeeded over the... No, they haven't. They fit into a divine plan. It behooves the church to be humiliated. And the organization we're talking about all the time, never talking about the mystical body, or the souls in purgatory, or the souls in heaven, or the souls on earth. We're talking about the organization. It no longer serves Christ's purpose. Apparently he's liquidating it without a scruple. He's allowed it to go under in France, in Italy, in Spain, in America, in Canada, in Ireland. He's allowed it to go Belgium, Holland, Austria. Where has it not gone under? It's gone under everywhere. He allowed that. So what's happening to the church, the destruction of the church, the failure, the treachery of priests and of bishops, the failure of popes, he knows all that and allows it to happen. He collaborates with it. The terrible thing about it is that when Mary watched the scourging or watched Jesus on Calvary, she had to will it. She didn't stand there and say, "Oh, those awful men. Those awful men, how dare they do that?" No, she wanted it to happen. "They should stop this. Please stop it." No, she didn't. It was God's will that it happened. And therefore she had to conform to his will. Do you understand? That's a mystery. And the agony in the garden, the same thing. She had to will that he suffer this, because that's God's will. You have to accept God's will. And therefore, if he wills it to happen, in spite of his own intentions, just because he's given freedom of action to popes and priests and bishops and Catholics, and they misbehave themselves, he wills it. You must accept it and fight against it, do your best to overcome it, repair it, etc. But you must accept it as his will. It is his will. Otherwise, it wouldn't happen. Similarly with the church. This is what I call the Emmaus factor. There's no doubt about it that the idea that we must suffer, the Messiah has to be crucified, has to die and be buried and covered with obloquy and disgraced and ruined in his reputation with the Jewish people at that time and be humiliated as a felon and die with the criminals. That is contrary to everything human, contrary to all our wishes. And by the way, let me say a word about it to bring home the horror of it all. We have descriptions of crucifixions in Roman literature. And one writer says that they always had one place, a high place, just outside the city walls, where they crucified the men. And he said that the characteristic, to paraphrase his Latin, the characteristic of all the crucifixion places was sanguis. Sanguis. Ubique sanguis. Blood. Blood. Everywhere blood. It smelt of blood, it was always bloody. Never washed down. And crows settled there and wild animals when people weren't there. And Jesus was crucified between two men. The curses, the smells, the groans, the pains, the laughter of the soldiers who had great fun with the whole thing, was gruesome. It was a dreadful way to die. A dreadful way to die. And in pain, every pain, every part of your body paining at the same time. And it's horrible. There was blood everywhere. His blood was all over the legionaries that crucified him. Because you know the way they crucified you was that you carried your cross, which was a cross beam, and you were thrown on the ground. Your hands were nailed to that, while one legionary sat on your belly to quiet you. One sat on your feet, one sat in your chest, and one sat in the other hand. While they nailed this hand, then he transferred over and nailed the other hand. Then they lifted you up, nailed to the crossbeam, and they dropped it into the socket of this upright, which was there permanently. Then they nailed your feet one by one. I mean, everywhere is covered with blood. It was the blood of Jesus this time. But it was sanguis, sanguis, ubique sanguis. Blood, blood, everywhere blood. And the smell of it. And then all the prisoners defecated and urinated the moment they were hanging on the cross. They had no control at all. They vomited and retched. And then the soldiers were casting lots and sitting down and watching. The Bible says that they sat down and they watched Jesus. Eterunaton is the Greek. They watched him like you watch an animal. That's how he died. You must hold that God willed all that. You must hold that he willed all that. Similarly with the church. The sufferings we're going through, and the pain, and the humiliation, and the disruption, and the disgrace, and the irreverence, and the blasphemy, and the violation of all our rules, marriage rules, and baptismal rules, and communion rules, and rules for children, and rules for chastity. All that is willed by God. He's permissively allowing that. And we must accept it. Because thus we enter into our glory. What does that teach us? It teaches this, that Christ has no further use for this organization. And he's not sending an earthquake to wipe out the whole thing. No, he's letting it liquidate itself. It's corrupt, and it's liquidating itself. What will come out of it? Oh, something I won't see. I doubt if you'll see it either, Bernard. You're too old. The new organization, such as, we don't know what it's going to be like. We do not know what it's going to be like. But he will create it, whole plot. And a new race will take over, who will not be blighted like our race, with our sins.
So it seems what's happening is much like the crucifixion and resurrection then of our Lord.
That's right, that's right. And then remember what happened. After Pentecost, the church went literally underground until the year 312. That was over 200 years later. God creates a little acorn and he spends 80 years making it into a huge oak tree. He is a person of infinite patience. And it doesn't matter how impatient we are, he's going to wait.
Now, could it be then that the fact that the church is being liquidated is a means of sowing the seeds for a revival?
No doubt.
Or resurrection through perhaps the underground church.
Yeah, no doubt in my mind about it at all. In the meantime, what should be done will not be done. But what should be done is this. The Vatican Council has at least 5 documents that contradict tradition.
So there's problems right in the documents of Vatican II.
Yeah. It says that you are free to be wrong. I'm sorry, the church has always condemned that. You have no liberty. Error has no rights. So you have no right to be wrong. And I will not defend your right to be wrong, but you have no right to be wrong. Number one. Number two, the church has always said that marriage, the purpose of marriage, is uniquely the procreation of children. Secondarily, it is mutual help. But only secondarily. Now, it's different. It's the mutual love of the parents and the procreation of children. That's against Catholic doctrine. De fide doctrine. Thirdly, the church has always said the Pope only has universal jurisdiction over everybody, He is as much powerful in this small little diocese in the pampas of Argentina as he is in New York. Vatican Council says no. The bishops share his universal jurisdiction. I'm sorry, that's against church doctrine. And you can go through documents like that and show that tradition is contradicted by the Vatican doctrine. Because now a pope, what John Paul II should have done, if I can give you a should have done for this pope, he should have sat down and reconciled those with tradition and said, this is how we must understand it, because this is what tradition has always said. He didn't. Neither did Paul VI. They're both at fault. And later theologians and the church will, they never say a pope is wrong, but they will correct it. They will correct it, because that's the way doctrine goes. It's corrected by a later generation when it's false. The emeritus factor then is this belief that what is happening in the church is the hand of purifying the organization, purifying the church, purifying the visible house that houses Catholicism while preparing for a better day. That is complicated slightly by the fact that we have the testimony of Our Lady in apparitions that are, in appearances of Our Lady that are approved of by the Church, which suggests awfully strongly, in fact you can't contradict it really if you're truthful, that there's going to be a visitation, a heavenly visitation of mankind by God in punishment of mankind's sins. I don't see how anybody can get away with that unless he wants, like John 23rd, to deny the validity of any of these.
So we're perhaps in an Old Testament situation, let's say, like before the flood at the time of Noah, where God is going to impose some type of punishment
that's
on mankind.
That's right. That's right.
Because the people had grown wicked.
That's right. And this is God's way of doing it. And it's not simply a flood. It's not simply a disease or a plague. It's something far worse. And it is very hard to get away from that conclusion unless you're a total cynic and you don't accept any approved appearance of Our Lady, appearances approved by the Church. If you do, that's fine, but you may have a rude surprise someday. And I don't think you can do that. You can't get away with that. So I think that the Queen of Heaven has quite manifestly warned us that in our lifetimes, that is within this span of decades, there's going to be trouble. And I think there is.
Now, we have alluded to it in our conversations up till now, and actually there was in Windswept House a proposal for an underground church by Cessy. What role does this underground church play?
It plays this role. It provides for a limited number of people a valid mass and valid sacraments. That's very important. But it's only for a certain limited number of people, because the ministers, the priests and bishops in the underground church are few. The numbers are huge on one side and small on the other side. So from the point of view of numerical significance, none, whatever. But there is this constant thing which is bugging, if I use that awful word, which is bothering the conciliarist church, the normal bishops, that they're attracting more and more people when they can't attract people. And they're attracting vocations to their seminaries when the bishops can't get vocations. Now, of course, we know that some bishops don't want vocations. They're discouraging vocations because they don't want priests any longer. But those are the apostates. That's their function for Satan and for Lucifer, is to discourage priesthood. Now, what's going to happen? What's going to happen is that the church is going to be marginalized more and more. The organized church is going to have its usual crowd of people, never very great. It's not going to have much religious influence. It has very little grace, supernatural grace about it. It's going to have less and less vocations, and they're going to have priestless parishes. They have them already, and they're going to have much more than that. And therefore, they're going to be diminished in number and in revenue. And the religious orders are going to go on having very few vocations, the Jesuits. What is it, they ordained one man last year or something like this? Something dreadful. And the Carmelites and Dominicans, the same thing, a dearth of people. And as for the nuns, forget it, except for certain religious orders. We're not going to have any nuns orders, religious orders. After about 20 years, there will be only one or two big ones, and then a sprinkling of small ones, and it's all over. We have no orders of nursing sisters or missionary sisters coming up. They're dying out. They're dying out. So, time will tell, but I think the big factor, Bernard, is what happens in the skies. In fact, I'll explain myself. I think that keep your eyes on the skies is a very good motto. I think that Our Lady's sign is going to appear in the skies soon, not late. I think it's going to come as a shock to everybody. It's going to alert everybody that there is a God and that they are redevable, as the French say, that they are responsible to him. It won't convert anybody. It'll confirm those with faith. It may help those who are quavering in their faith. It won't give anybody any faith. It'll just show him where he or she is in God's sight. But it won't make them believe. And I think that is coming soon. In other words, I don't think the present situation where the church is dying by dribs and drabs, like its pope is dying in dribs and drabs, I don't think that's going to go on indefinitely until the church dies out. I think it's going to be hit hard by what appears in the skies. And I don't mind climbing out on a limb on that matter. In fact, I'll say this much, and this is the beginning of spring. I'd say that if by the end of spring there is a sign in the sky, in the human skies that we see, an abnormal happening, then we can say that the big change is coming fast. If there's nothing, then the big change is coming later. But it's coming.
And of course Our Lady has worked its way in the past. Let's say before, it wasn't the Second World War, there was a sign from heaven or from Our Lady that the Second World War was coming.
But nobody paid any attention to it. The only person who paid attention to it was Hitler. You know that?
No.
Yep, Hitler was in Berchtesgaden, his wolf's lair, the night of the big, what they called Aurora Borealis. And he's standing there watching this, all his main people. Goering was there, and Goebbels was there, and Himmler was there, and they were watching this, and his main aides. And they said, Führer, was denken Sie? What do you think? What do you think? He said, now we're going to shed blood. Now we have to shed blood. By that time he had gobbled up Czechoslovakia, he had gobbled up Austria, he had taken what he liked, he said, now it's cost us no blood, not one German has died, now we're going to shed blood. That was his reading. Whereas in America, in Europe, they said this is Aurora Borealis. We never really knew it wasn't Aurora Borealis. They knew it was something special. But they never really knew it. That doesn't appear in the New York Times at the time. They hid it all. Just as in 1986, when the miracle of Fatima took place in Rome and was photographed by Rai Televisione, and they wouldn't show it in America. They showed it all over Europe, but they wouldn't show it in America. What happened was, just an anecdote, but it does illustrate Our Lady's, the suppression of Our Lady's news by the media. There's a place called Tre Fontane, Three Fountains, where Our Lady has a shrine. And every year there's a celebration there on the 12th of April. That's the anniversary. And the cameras were there because there were always cardinals. There's a big celebration. There were about 12 cardinals there. And they were all photographing the event, the mass and the procession and the sermon, etc. And suddenly the sun started dancing around, so they just moved the cameras up and took it. I have the tape. They took a complete tape of it. And it's very frightening. It's Fatima, the sun dancing around, coming at you, and changing colors. And all of Europe saw, but nobody in America saw.
So we could be in a situation similar to Fatima, where these signs are not widely talked about or reported
broadcast
in the media.
That's right. That's right. We are in that situation. And they will not announce it. They do not want to give any publicity to heaven and to heaven's signs. But you see, when there will be a sign which they can't neglect, because every people will see it no matter where they are, be in Kathmandu, Nepal, or be on the top of Mount Everest, or be in the Gobi Desert, or on the Great Reef, or in the Pampas, or in Chile, or in Alaska. No matter where you are, you're going to see this sign, you will see it. It will appeal to you directly, personally. That's the terrible thing that's going to come. And then the effect of that's going to be big. Now, my belief, and I don't see how anybody can get away from it, unless we're all crazy and things are all upside down, and that is coming very soon. Soon? When is it? I don't know. I've given my measurement. If there's a sign in the sky, not the hail bop either, but if there's a sign in the sky before the end of our spring, before the end of May, then it's coming soon. Otherwise, it's going to be late. Later.
The example you gave from scriptures involved recognition of our Lord, and how those two disciples failed to recognize him.
Yes.
Faithful Catholics today have to deal with the problem of recognition. How do they recognize, how does a faithful Catholic recognize if the parish that one's in is still Catholic?
I'll tell you, Bernard, all of us today, certainly all the people you know and all the people I know, are educated to the point they can find out if they want to. If the parish priest says that now it's not necessary to go to Mass and Communion once a year, you can find that out very simply. If he says, if he makes any statement about doctrine that sounds funny and different from what you were taught, you can find out. There are people to ask and books to read and places to write to and places to phone. You can always find out. The difference between us and our fathers, the people who went before us, is that they hadn't got to do that. They had reliable priests. We haven't. We now are faced with the dilemma that we don't know. And when you're faced with the hierarchy as you have in Canada and in America that tolerated sex ed in the schools, you know you can't trust them. Whatever you do, don't trust the thing they say. Test it always, find out. Because they are liars, and they have lost two generations of children to sex ed and to pornography.
So really the answer is then that we have to work a little harder for our salvation than we've had to, let's say,
yep,
the 1950s.
Yeah, yeah, and you can't excuse that by saying the priest told me. You know now the priests are not reliable until you prove they are. You know the bishops are not reliable until you prove they are. It's a dreadful situation. Well, you know the Pope must be listened to very carefully so that he doesn't voice something which is wrong on us, because he does voice things that are wrong. Not so that he ceases to be Pope, but certainly that he's spouting doctrine which is not Catholic. So you've got to be sensible about it and find out.
Now, Windswept House discussed the issue of the Mass. Are there problems in the new Mass?
There are such problems in the new Mass that it's impossible to have a valid new Mass unless you take special care. Of itself, as following the instructions, it's going to be invalid. It's going to be invalid. Now, that has dreadful consequences. Because, by the way, you should ask me, and I should answer, why it's invalid. For two reasons. It can be invalid on account of the rite itself, R-I-T-E, the ceremony you used. It can be wrong, it can be invalid because of the intention. Suppose I'm a seminarian, and I'm going to a certain seminary, and the priest, the teacher who teaches me sacramentology, about sacraments, never teaches me that's the body and blood of Jesus. He doesn't believe in transubstantiation. He believes in something called transignification. That is, that somehow or other the bread and the wine come to signify the presence of Christ, but they're not the body of Christ. Because remember that, as Catholics, we've got to believe this bread is now the flesh of Jesus, and this wine is now the blood of Jesus.
So for validity, the priest has to have the right intention.
Well, how can he have the right intention if he doesn't know the doctrine? That's my point. Suppose he's not taught the doctrine. He's taught the very opposite, a heresy. He doesn't believe that. He hasn't got the intention of confecting the sacraments of the body and blood of Christ. Therefore, he hasn't got the intention. Therefore, he's not doing that. He must know. I mean, how can he have the intention without knowing? You can't. It's not merely a right, it's your intention that counts. It's your intention that counts. For instance, if I'm a mother, I am dying, I have a baby just born, and I have no Christian near me, I only have a pagan woman who's a good woman and is my servant. I say, please, Rita, let's call her maid Rita. Rita, please, take a glass of water and pour it on the head of my baby, or on its foot, or its hand, or face, whatever. And say the words, I baptize thee in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And please do it with the intention that my church has. That's different. Because then this pagan woman does that, pours the water, and says, I baptize you, John, or the baby's name, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And I do that with the intending to do what this lady's church says it does. That baby is baptized. Now with the priest, who takes the bread and the wine, doesn't believe, doesn't know that that it must become the body and blood of Christ, and that he can do it if he's ordained. He can't intend to do what he doesn't know. He's been told the wrong thing. That's the difficulty. That's number one. Number two, perhaps he's not validly ordained. Even if he had the best intention in the world, knew the proper words, without being ordained, his sacraments are invalid. He doesn't confect the sacrament. He doesn't transfer it from body and blood, from bread and wine to body and blood. So there's a double whammy against him. Furthermore, he may be invalidly ordained because the bishop is invalidly consecrated. The difficulty goes back and back and back in the modern church. We don't know, and there's nobody, not even the Pope, who knows how many priests are validly or invalidly ordained, how many bishops are validly or invalidly consecrated. We don't know. The church hasn't inquired into it. It's one of the things they should have checked on after the Vatican Council, checked into the sacraments, the anointing of the ill, the extreme unction, as we used to call it, for dying people. The present ceremony, in my estimation, is invalid. It doesn't forgive you your sins, and therefore it doesn't help you to die well and go to heaven. You go to purgatory or wherever you're destined to go.
So the difficulty then is with the new Mass and the new sacraments is that they are of dubious validity, which brings you back then to the whole subject of the underground church, that for valid sacraments then you'd have to make use of it.
That's why people do, and people call me up and ask me, Father, I've only got the past 10th people near here, can I go to their Mass? Can I go to confession to them? Is it invalid? You say, no, it's not invalid, you can go there. They're not schismatics either, and they're not. But people have great scruples about it, but at least they know it's valid.
Now let's discuss what the components of the underground church is. We just talked about the Society St. Pius X. Are they part of the underground church?
Yes, they are. Mostly they're underground. By underground I mean not official. Not official. Functioning without any approval of the church authorities. Then there are, apart from them, there is the Pius V organization, which is the same status, same condition. They have valid bishops.
Now, is there a situation then where another element of the underground church is, let's say, retired bishops and priests who are training seminarians in secret?
That's there. One seminary is composed completely of retired priests who are retired professors, who are told to be retired, who are full of energy at the age of 75 and didn't want to retire at all. They want to teach good theology. So they do. So they're in it. Then I suppose there are minor organizations like the former followers of Father Feeney will be reckoned underground because they don't belong to the official church. They're there, they're tolerated, but they don't belong to the official church. And they always have the traditionalist Mass. They don't have the other Mass. That's roughly is the underground church.
You also, I think, have, and I've known some priests who have, let's say, a parish.
Oh, yeah.
And they function in that parish, but also they're saying Mass in a clandestine way for small groups of people.
Single priests, sure.
I think, wasn't there a a precedent for that in the Protestant Reformation. Some Anglican priests continued to function in a clandestine way.
And they do that today. And then the last element in the Anglican Church is the reservation of the Blessed Sacrament. We now reserve the Blessed Sacrament in private houses for two parents and their friends. And they keep it there, they know how to deal with it, they know how to keep it clean, they know what, when to renew it, to go to the priest who will renew it for them. So we have the, they have the Blessed Sacrament because they say, we haven't got it in the church, we can't make a visit, we can't have exposition of the Blessed Sacrament. And some of them are little monsters, they have exposition for a small group, it's always limited, and it's very hard to find out where it is.
And that's one of the difficulties in the modern church, is that it's next to impossible to practice your faith there, because let's say you go to make a visit to the Blessed Sacrament, and the church is locked.
It's locked. And if you do, you don't know where the Blessed Sacrament is. If it's there.
You sometimes, like, it's pushed off to the side.
Yeah, it's in a box inside the sacristy. It isn't there. So it's a difficulty. That's the underground church. Is it growing? Yes, slowly. Very slowly. Nothing big, nothing sudden. I guess the underground church will grow very big when Our Lady's sign comes in the sky. I think it's going to be very high. But the present moment is growing by steadily, 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 by little leaps and steps. And if the bishops of this country alone, forget Canada, knew how influential the underground church was, they would really be, they'd get very upset. They get very, very upset.
So, perhaps though, God is keeping the underground church small for reasons maybe that we don't understand. Just like in, let's say, the Old Testament, a remnant has kept the faith during difficult times.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, I think so. But anyway, you see, Bernard, the belief of the Catholic Church has always been, until the present moment, that the number of the saved is a minority. Not a majority, a minority. Now you go and tell the normal priest today that, or tell the local bishop that, and they'll spit at you. Because that's very unpopular doctrine today.
But didn't our Lord himself say that?
Well, yes, but our Lord said a lot of things, but now the church knows better. This is the argument anyway. None of the majority would say that. The majority would say that the majority of believers, the majority of people are saved. The present pope would say that every man at his conception is saved. He will say that. He gets grace at his conception. That becomes very, very difficult. For me, anyway. All that will be corrected in time. In the meantime, we have to go through this mess, this ambiguity. And if, for instance, let's take the Roman Catholic Catechism, the New Catechism. Bernard, every dogma of the Church is in the New Catechism. Every dogma is there, infallibly. But side by side and mixed up with it is a lot of ambiguity, which, of course, immediately creates doubt about the dogma. And as you just said a moment ago, the old Latin tag that St. Thomas repeats and several other people have, sacramentum dubium nullum sacramentum. A doubtful sacrament is not a sacrament. You've got to repeat it. So if I doubt your baptism, I must repeat the baptism. And sometimes at Mass, when you're very tired, a priest will say, did I say the proper words? And he'll go back and repeat the words of consecration to make sure that they're done. You can't be doubtful about a sacrament. There's no such thing as, probably it was a sacrament. There's no such thing.
Now here is, another situation that faithful Catholics have to deal with. In the past, heretics were usually fairly honest about their heresy.
That's right.
They would just say, well, we believe this and the church believes that.
That's right.
Today it seems to be more complicated. They don't say we're contradicting what is done in the past.
No, they don't. They say we have another opinion in the church today, and I partake of that opinion. And they just pretend or claim that it's perfectly legitimate. And there is such a variety today, such a variety, that, I mean, you can find people saying, for instance, Charles Curran, the man who belongs to the Rochester Diocese, he will hold things and he'll set their Catholic doctrine. He'll hold that you can even commit bestiality if it suits you, and it's not a sin. He'll say that's Catholic. And he's a priest of good standing in the Rochester Diocese, and he can hear confessions there under the famous Bishop Matthew Clark. So it's the confusion is awful today. The Catholic Catechism says, for instance, that of course homosexuality is a distortion, is intrinsically evil. However, some people can't help it; they're born like that. And it says we must welcome homosexuals. What on earth does all that mean?
There was actually a situation in Canada that was reported by the press, where the Minister of Justice, who is on paper anyway a Catholic, and the government was passing pro-homosexual legislation, and he quoted the New Catechism in defense of what he was doing.
Sure. And that's why I'm saying it's ambiguous. It can be quoted out of both sides of your mouth. And that is deliberate, because that creates confusion. So much so that I have never used the Catholic Catechism practically. I use the Catechism of the Council of Trent, which is absolutely clear on every point, including homosexuality. So it's something else. You've got to be very careful. And the Catechism cannot be taken as being infallible. It's not. It's laced with ambiguity and un-Catholic sentiments, and can be used against the Church.
Is perhaps a pattern coming out here where perhaps almost all the documents that have come out since Vatican II have this kind of ambiguity. Let's say the new catechisms, the new mass, the new sacraments.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you're forced to fall back upon tradition, what the Church, let's say, has always used in the past.
Pre-1962. And then that can become very embarrassing, because if you take, for instance, the Pope's last, and this present Pope's last encyclical, that they may be one, Ut Unum Sint, you find he's contradicting Pius the 11th. That was only 40 years ago. He's contradicting him.
Could Catholics perhaps be witnessing, with, and there seems to be various movements in this direction, an effort to reshape the papacy? Because it seems perhaps that the modernists aren't just happy with capturing it, they also want to reshape it. Do you think we can look forward to that?
Not only look forward, we have it. The present Holy Father holds and behaves as if he is only infallible when he agrees with his bishops.
So there you have the teaching of collegiality then actually coming into being, and that has already reshaped the papacy.
That's right. And now, remember, the theory of collegiality was condemned as a heresy. It's called Gallicanism. It's condemned already by the First Vatican Council. But it reasserted itself in the Second Vatican Council and was approved with Paul VI's permission.
I think, too, part of the perspective that Catholics have to have is when people talk, let's say, about the New World Order and the coming apostasy, they talk about it as if it's all already, like it's coming up in the future.
That's right.
But don't we have to recognize that it's all, basically, most of it is already here?
It's here. It's here. We're in apostasy. And the New World Order is a fact, whether we like it or not. And all you've got to do is to look at, for instance, the behavior of the big, important people like Maurice Strong and Kofi Annan, the head of the United Nations, and the other leaders of large-scale proposals, and it's the New World Order. It's dragooning us all, and we can't get out of it now. Whether we like it or not, the New World Order is here.
And how did we get from there to here? Because it all seems to have happened without most people even realizing it.
And without their consent.
Yes.
They never consented. But we were never asked about it. We were never asked. They don't ask us that.
But haven't people been a bit asleep in the past 30 years?
They have. They've trusted their legal representatives, their elected representatives. We have trusted them.
And we've trusted our parish priests and bishops.
That's right. We've trusted our cardinals. We've trusted our popes. We've trusted everybody. But we can't go on trusting. We must examine them. Remember, Reagan had this thing of trust but verify. Remember, he used to repeat these two Russian words?
Right.
We Americans sit here continually. Yes, I'll trust the Russians, but I'm going to verify what they say. When they say we've shifted missiles, okay, I believe you, but I'm going to verify. Have you shifted them? So similarly with this. You have to verify always. It's extraordinary what you have to verify. There are the most extraordinary things you have to verify sometimes. Because something can be put on you without your knowing it. and something is being put over on us already in the Catholic Church. As I say, when I talk to people, and I talk to them continually in this diocese alone, they're always saying, "You're kidding. I didn't know that." It's the truth they're always using. They don't realize, they don't read, and their own priests don't tell them. The priests just keep giving the same pap. And they only talking to somebody like me or some writer or some theologian standing up on his own, they suddenly realize there's a big change taking place, and they weren't told about it.